some hill vigor. Have on that drink and own some of the day. My pistols getting thirsty, now I need some of the drink.
So I'm outside of the club and he think I'm a pawn. So I go to my loaded tank, now that's off in the trunk. I told him, motherfucker,
any bum with a hollow heat seeker. Red Cross, bitch niggas, fuck the pint. She take blood by the leader, I never leave her. My vicious vixen, on liquor, send that ass to God quicker. No matter your religion, you Muslim, Hebrew, or Christian. She indiscriminate with punishment, she send them missing. My gun's my favorite bitchin', and she got permanent PMS, so she stay
bitchin'.
Promote your business. DJ Lab known to keep the hottest record spinning. Mix, mix a lot and Tay Mac discuss the hottest topic. Those not a 2000 to let you know what's really popping. Miss Lit, gon' make sure she get the mangles right. Making moves even though she's staying out of sight. Check the website, Misfits Media Group. Keep it 100, cause that's how they gon' give it to you. Something for anyone and everyone from every walk. 365, 24/7, got music and talk. Sundays, you know we getting in the mix. 3 to 5 with Westside Misfits. Kick facts, play music, and talk slick. Tell a friend to tell a friend to get in the mix. Tell a friend to tell a friend to get in the mix. Tell a friend to tell a friend to get in the mix. Sundays, you know we getting in the mix. From 3 to 5 with Westside Misfits. We in the mix, we in the mix, we in the mix. We in the mix, 3 to 5,
we in the mix.
We love you.
Tell a friend.
You
are officially in the mix, baby. I am Ms. Mix-a-Lot.
I am Dos Nada 2000.
I am DJ Lab.
All right, and you know we got Slick 316 in the building, baby. Hey, man, happy Father's Day, fathers.
Thank you.
Yes. It's always a turn up for the fathers.
Yes.
Things have gotten a lot better for you fathers.
Yeah, looking up.
Yes. Mm-hmm. You know, the thing about it is I put up a post earlier in the week just kind of, you know, reminded women that regardless of how many roles you play, dual roles, whatever it is that you play, like, we're not taking anything away from you, but fathers are men.
That's right.
And that's just what it is.
And we get one day, can we have that day?
Exactly. And my thing is, it's better to disassociate or not even speak on the bad fathers and just uplift the ones that you know doing the right thing, you know?
It's much better to do that.
Just if you don't mention them, guess what? They irrelevant. Don't nobody know who they are.
Right.
Yeah, like it's just that, and then we have to, and I always have to take into consideration too. I always like to just kind of enlighten women on, we have a role as women in how we choose the men that we lay down with. Mm. So we hold some responsibility. Absolutely, we hold some responsibility in, you know, in choosing the men that we choose, that we lay down with, you know. And a lot of times they don't want to, I didn't know it. Okay, well, I can understand, because I will say that the men that I have kids with, I am the first, my kids are the first of their kids. So sometimes you don't know. Mm. But I still know I hold responsibility in choosing to procreate with them. Do. You know, so.
We are responsible. Y'all know my motto, pick better.
Pick better, exactly. Pick so better. It's kind of like, you know, don't just kind of like make all of the guys feel a certain type of way just because you pick wrong. Like, don't do that. I don't think that shit cool. Like, seriously. Yeah. Like, we hold some responsibility in that. And sometimes it's hard for women to understand or see that, because I didn't choose it. It doesn't matter that you chose whatever you chose. It's just the point of, it's just the point of, we hold some responsibility. So, fathers. Y'all step out in y'all linen so nobody don't ask y'all to get on that grill.
Oh, yeah, you already know. It's some daddies right now on the grill, mad as hell.
Exactly. Sweating,
smelling like smoke. The wrong smoke.
Yes. And look, we got one of my favorite people in the building.
I told you I had one for
you. You did. I got it. You know what? DJ Loud, and he's so low down, he wouldn't even tell me.
No, but I had to tell her that it was a guest because they would not come. She was like, well, I don't feel good today. I ain't coming. Yeah. So I wanted to make sure that.
Okay.
You thought I would do that?
Well, you know, sometimes you wake up on Saturday and don't feel like doing it. I mean.
On Saturday, I'll say.
Yeah, but we've been planning this since Tuesday.
Oh, okay. good. Well, I am excited, even more excited now, man. Like, I just love good men. Like, I like to be surrounded with that energy, that love, all of that matters to me.
You like that surprise? What to the rest of the surprise he tell you about?
Oh, okay. Really?
Yeah,
well, say that. I can't wait. but yeah, I just wanted to tell you guys, man, none of your good deeds, none of your work go unnoticed, fathers. You know, as sometimes I know you feel unappreciated, you feel overwhelmed. It's a lot going on because it is a lot of responsibility, parenting, period. So just let today be one of those easygoing days. Don't let nobody work your nerves. Just kind of go with the flow. And, you know, I honestly feel like you all deserve it.
That's right.
Thank you. We appreciate it.
I feel like that, too.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. I, you know, I,
what?
You know.
He's talking about, you know. Well, we're going to get, DJ Lab, we're going to let you get in the mix, and then we're going to bring our guests on where he can introduce himself and let everybody know what's going on. Thank you.
I ain't lost it. It was in my other pants. Ooh. Yeah. Strapped up, ready to whip some. Swagged up, pistoled up, my whistle ready to rip some. I'm back, and they still praying. Big mop that I'm still running. Rep up in this motherfucker, bitch, I'm ready to kill some. I'm back, like I left some. Strapped up, ready to whip some. Swagged up, pistoled up, my whistle ready to rip some. I'm back. And they still praying. Big mob that I'm still running. Rep up in this motherfucker, bitch, I'm ready to kill some. My beam long, my team strong. Nigga background playing my theme song. That whoa shit, that whole shit. I grab the mic, talk mo shit. Get fresh, getting my pose on. Ducked off, getting my swole on. Been a few years, shed a few tears. Life shit still goes on. No steel sick, it's nauseous. No shouts, no louses. Used to run around real reckless. I ride around real cautious. Used to hit the south, get my face blow. Get geeked up, throwing Chase hoes, said fuck them hoes. Flow my nose, got my money up, nigga, case closed. All about my pesos. Boss niggas do boss things. Fuck all that flousing. Get the future right for my offspring. Make a way, then pay the way. Ref came through straight, say it day. Hit the mic up, put the AK away. I'm back, nigga, we should not stay.
Oh, she got me like, oh. my brain that I can't explain. I don't wanna let it go because I love the pain. The way you put that thing on me, you almost broke my chain. And now you got mixed emotions. The way you fucking on a nigga got you wetter than the ocean. She wanna drink, we sipping on that magic potion. Your love, what a joy, now they got me go tight.
Nigga can't strike from that bottle. Got a problem, we gon' solve it. You know I keep the revolver. Nigga, we used to ride mud, and now I pull up in the port. Remember my first day when I jumped out of port. Swear that this trap and shit need be a sport. Take that little powder, whip up with the fork. Hey, yeah, swear that this life is a movie. Swear that these niggas we Uzi. Little bitch overrated, I play with that coochie. Fuck that little bitch in jacuzzi. Worrying about nothing, I'm Gucci. Faded like Gucci. Chopper gon' kiss you like smooches. Spit on the beat, I ain't talking no mucus. Chop up the beat, then I screw it. Yeah, chop up the beat, then I screw it.
I cannot cope, life in a joke. I just be blowing on smoke. Too much pain for the dope. Blowing smoke out the smoke. Champagne for the pain. Ducking water when it rains. Bitch, I'm hotter than the sun. Twiggy hot fire flames. But I cannot take it no more. These niggas be broke, these bitches be hoes. These niggas be calling you friends, but all in the end, these niggas be foes. A nigga like me can't jack that. 40 on me, better back. Got the 40 on me, no rap cap. I shoot to kill, that's a hash fact. Yo, remember them days, used to be starving for days. Shaking, swerving, busting plays, all in and out of state. Mom and dad fucked in February, that's why November's so legendary. Papa told me he ain't never scary. I told my son this shit a radical.
Yeah, I'm having ice, nigga. Only fuck that bitch up for one night, nigga. Niggas don't ask me for no feet, you know the price, nigga. I got all kind of bitches, different vibes, nigga. Yeah, bitch, yeah, flirty, yeah, big block, dirty, yeah, know my cup, dirty, yeah, know my cup, money, yeah. I don't fuck with them, I fuck with savage, still my buddies. If your bitch come by me gang, then you know she getting slutty.
Know we get mine like the ass. And I fuck real hood babies. I ride a little boy like a baby. My diamond ain't hitting like shining. Little nigga, they mad, get out of here. I want the green, the cheese, the broccoli. Straight to the top, them niggas ain't stopping me. I'm a savage, I ain't talking about 21. Glock 19, ho 31. Shoot a little bitch in my finger, no. And tell them nigga we ain't fearing no. No, I'm too tough on the go. Ride that little boy with a rope. Cross that bitch, I like D-Rose. Fuck that little bitch in the throat.
Yeah, I'm having ice, nigga. Only fuck that bitch up for one night, nigga. Please don't ask me for no feet, you know the price, nigga. I got all kind of bitches, different vibes, nigga. Yeah, bitch, yeah, flirty, yeah. Big Glock 30, yeah. Know my cup, dirty, yeah. Know my cup, money, yeah. I don't fuck with them, I fuck with Savage, they're my buddies. If your bitch come by the game, then you know she getting slutty.
Yeah, I play with your buddy, I pull up 100
round
drones,
you know you
gon'.
So, we had, what, Javon Suavis, mm-hmm. Gotti and Cody, mm-hmm. Ellen F., and Lakeith.
Lakeith.
Okay, DJ Lab, getting these independent artists played.
That's right.
I love it. Mm-hmm. So, Lakeith is, what song did Lakeith have? Yeah. And that's exactly how it sounds. Who y'all? Yes, like literally.
That was my favorite song while I'm tripping.
That is how, you don't believe it, Rico? Okay, we'll play it next time.
It was fun, like.
Yeah, look, usually it is for our age group. We like,
I just met a
we look the way our parents look when we was used to play music. They be like, what is that?
Yeah, what's that?
Mm-hmm.
So we do the same thing except for that beats be jamming.
You like that song too. What's the name of that song?
So, we do have a guest in the building, Mr. Michael Morning.
Right.
How are you?
Good. How you guys doing?
We are doing okay. We trying to hang in now with all of this, everything, but we are doing okay for the most part.
It's rough. We're going to get through it.
Yes, I do believe we are. You know, the thing about it is, one thing about us, as people, as a nationality, we are strong and resilient by nature. Like, it's kind of like circumstances has made us, you know, just pretty much be who we have to be and kind of conform to whatever it is that's going on. So now we just want to try to get everybody else to kind of see our value and just kind of know that we're not the enemy. Mm. It's, you know, bad people in every nationality or every race, but don't count
Black
us
lives
out.
Matter too.
That's only right. What you do, Lab?
We matter too.
And look, we are live. Let me just tell y'all that. So when y'all hear DJ Lab messing up, it is a live situation here.
Yeah.
But yeah, so that's just the main thing. We want to be treated fair. So we just kind of, you know.
How was your protesting
experience? Well, you know what? It was okay. The thing about it is, you know, like I mentioned before, when you protesting, you want to get something out of it. I was actually out supporting KIPP Metro Atlanta Schools.
Oh.
Yeah, it was their protest. And it was basically because, you know, like with KIPP, you have all different nationalities teaching. You have all different nationalities in higher positions and stuff in the school system. And they wanted to just get out there and express themselves and let them know that we have their full participation. We have their support and things of that nature. So it was nice. It was really hot. Those 8 minutes and 46 seconds really was a long time.
Did you kneel?
They forgot about us in a skirt. I kneeled in a skirt. And I was just like, is anybody keeping time? Because maybe I should have started. And it was all like, yeah, because everybody getting a little wobbly. You know what I'm saying? But it was nice, though. For the most part, we all came together. Like I said, I'm going to tell you something. The principal, and I think I mentioned this last week, the principal that used to be the principal of KIPP Atlanta Collegiate, which is the high school for KIPP. And he just basically got up and he was just saying that racism basically started with white people, so it has to end with them.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, it has to end with us. And he was very, the one thing about him, he was straightforward and he just made people understand what was going on. And he was just like, and he was telling them that how we hold ourselves accountable as, you know, as a white race is when you hear those smirks or when you hear those, you know, things being said, not to turn a blind eye to it, not to just take it to HR every time, just kind of check it, you know, and be like, you know, that was kind of out of order.
It's one thing to consider yourself not to be a racist, but you really have to be anti-racist.
Right.
I mean, you have to. You can't sit back there and be silent as you see other people being oppressed.
Right. And that's what he talked about. So I thought that was very good. I thought that was a very nice approach to, you know, what they had going on. Other than that, like, yeah, he's white. Yeah, he's white. He, very cool dude, though. You know, most of the kids he worked with are black, and he chose to work with these kids. It wasn't like, you know, like another situation where he was appointed there. No, he chose, he applied. He knew what he was getting himself into. And he was, you know, he was just like, I know how I was raised, and it just wasn't really like that. But I also know how a lot of my counterparts were raised, and it was like that.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So he was just like, I just feel like I chose to be a part of everything that that we're going through right now. So he with it. And there was a lot of other teachers, too, so it was really nice. Yeah, there was a lot of people that came out. We were social distancing, though. Yeah, like, we had the mask, and we were all, like, it was enough room for everybody, so.
Did you see the post that I put up about the record high that we hit yesterday?
The record who?
The record high in COVID cases that we hit yesterday.
Yes, I did. So, where I am with this at this point is that I just feel like with COVID, at this point, everybody is going to be exposed to it, but it's about making yourself healthy enough to fight it off. No, I'm so serious.
That's the truth. I think people already had it.
Yeah, people have already had it. Some have already have shown symptoms. Some have not. But I think at this point, you make your body strong enough to fight off anything that comes with it. I mean, seriously. Yeah, I remember you saying that, but it didn't arrive like that. That's the only problem. It was not like that when you got it.
Yeah.
The mango one, the new one you had just purchased.
Because
we had to get out the package and she's like, you were supposed to like, I said, well, I don't know nothing about sea moss.
That's why I took the
picture. I thought that was when you opened it.
That's when I got it, when I opened it.
No, you had already had it for a while, I thought.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, well, we'll talk about it. I don't know. Okay, well, I mean, I honestly don't know. I thought that's why we hadn't, we'll talk about it, though. So, yeah, so, like, with the sea moss and with the different things that you can do to build your immune system, I feel like at this point, that's what we need to do.
Yeah,
That's what we need to focus more on than anything, because like D.L. Hughley the other night, he just passed out.
That was crazy.
Yeah, like he tested positive for COVID and he was asymptomatic. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like at this point, it's kind of like, because they're saying that it's not even a it's a bacteria now, that it's not even a virus. So I'm confused about a lot of stuff. Well, they said that overseas they're doing autopsies on bodies that they classified as, away from COVID-19 or whatever. And they're doing autopsies, and in the autopsies, that's what they found. Have you heard that, Mike?
Hadn't heard that, but my picture on COVID and being asymptomatic and different things like that is that it's almost like us just having to believe in doctors who basically just draw hypotheses.
Exactly.
You know, they all have their own opinion about different things, so they're going to drive what they believe is the right way for us to go, and that may not be the right way, but of course all doctors have their own opinions, and it's upon us to kind of educate and empower ourselves to determine exactly which ones we want to listen to for the most part.
A doctor told me one time, he said, you know, this doctor thing, we just guessing.
It's practice.
It's like a mechanic.
We just guessing.
It's
we
practice.
Try one
it works need damn
work,
mechanic.
We try something else.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, see, this is
the
really
thing. We really don't know.
If you all, I don't know if you all can remember when HIV and AIDS was first, like, introduced to the world and how, okay, so our mom had a chance to work at IDP, which is the infectious disease clinic over on Ponce de Leon. But I remember how they had to interact with people like the mask, the washing of the hands, and you know, this person got it, you know, be really, really careful. And this is what the COVID-19 kind of remind me of, where as research kept coming and things kept developing, they would release certain things. But
the only difference is you catch COVID by somebody breathing on you. You had to fuck somebody to get that.
Well, they didn't. But you have to think about it.
Or blood transfusion.
But think about it. They didn't know that at first, though.
Oh, okay.
They didn't know that at first. Listen, they didn't know how people.
I'm just saying.
Think about it. They didn't know how people was getting HIV and AIDS. Oh. They just kept coming up with it.
Oh, okay.
So eventually, after all of this research and all of these things being done, then they said, oh, it's related to sex. Then it went, oh, it's related to gay sex. Then, so all of these different things were developed over time, though.
Right.
It was like years. And now, 2018, 2019, they come out with the vaccination that helps you not to contract HIV or AIDS.
But it's only for men.
No, it's for
women?
Yeah. So now they have this vaccination. Then they have the vaccination for HPV, which they later found out, in recent years, that HPV is what can cause cancer, like throat cancer for men and cervical cancer for women. So that's what I'm saying. Like, this COVID is kind of sort of like that. At this point, we're thinking it's all about breathing. We don't know.
Right. It's at an early stage.
Mm-hmm. I'll say a true live example I had actually when I was a kid. And my mom worked at Grady Hospital.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sitting out in the lobby at Grady and just waiting on her like I wait on her every day after school or before it's time for me to go to school. And one of her coworkers came out there and got me. Was like, hey, Mike, get up. And, you know, as I'm walking, she's like, that person has AIDS.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm looking back. Again, I'm probably grade school, second, third, fourth grade.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm looking back like, how you know that person got AIDS?
Right.
You know, we're all being educated at the same time, but I never heard you could get it by sitting next to somebody.
Right.
But it just shows the disconnect in our community and just in general how messages can be kind of
construed.
Yeah.
Absolutely. You know, it could come one way.
You don't know how you get, you just don't want to be rhyme.
You don't want to be
rhyme. Well, they say if you, you know.
And see, that's what I'm saying. That's why I'm telling y'all the correlation is so similar, because I remember this. I honestly remember, like, we couldn't go into certain places at Grady because, you know, like, they would have certain areas.
Yeah.
So, like, our parents worked together.
Mm-hmm.
So it was certain areas that we couldn't go. And as children, we don't really know.
Right.
It wasn't until we got older and was like, oh, okay. It started making sense.
Right.
And we're like, dang, we didn't even know that was that serious. Like, we was messing around, you know. Mm-hmm. But we didn't know. But
we thought everybody was gonna die from that shit.
Yeah.
Like, that, think about how serious that was. Like right. in that time, the message.
Exactly. Time, and like, what was and what we learned from it. So this is the same thing that our kids are going through now with COVID. Right. Mm-hmm. Like we don't know. They saying that you could breathe on somebody and get it. You probably can. But at the same time, it could be sexually transmitted as well.
And unfortunately, the shit? Kids in general and our youth, even adults, we just don't know how it works.
Mm. Right?
We don't know how it goes because you got all these examples of when you got people out there protesting, you got hundreds and thousands of people.
Right.
Then you go and see the different rallies, and then you'll go see different other events where people are actually congregating together. Mm-hmm. And then out of that, you got free test dummies, which is what you really got.
Right. Exactly.
If those numbers and don't really move, you're like, well, damn. What is it really?
Right. Exactly.
You know, so it's kind of hard if it's hard for adults, you can imagine how hard it is for the youth who's been cooped up in the house and got
right.
nothing to do to come up with a plan for you to tell them, hey, y'all don't need to do this.
Right.
And then they're messing with the numbers. Well, of course, they can always, but the thing about it is they are what do you call it when they do with the numbers? Like
statistics.
As far as statistics, but what do they do when they like not fluctuating the numbers?
Oh, fudge the numbers.
Yeah,
or,
like they make
manufacture numbers.
Yeah,
or,
they all so
you can
okay.
adjust the statistics.
Yeah, so that's the problem that I have where they're saying we're in phase two, and I'm like, well, you can't move to another phase until phase one is like phased out.
This is the thing in China. China has had a second outbreak in China. So they now everybody back on restrictions again in China. So, you know, they kind of leading the way with the bullshit. So I guess what they're saying is y'all expect the second wave. You get what I'm saying?
But that's what I'm saying. But how can we expect a second wave when we're still in the first wave? Like, that's
but the numbers are going down. The numbers have peaked. Listen, this is what they're considering. They're saying the numbers have peaked and they're plateauing, you know. That it is decreasing, so that's why it's going into the next phase. They're expecting another rapid increase. So, you know, we still easing out the first phase, but we still having cases picking up.
He's gonna kill it though.
Well, the governor said go to work, go to the party, go to the pool, go anywhere you want to go there.
Hey man, I had my PTSD.
Yes.
Hey my PTSD kicked in last night. What you call it, man? A talent show or something they had out at Club Miami and Beaver Ruin?
That's exactly what I'm talking about.
Oh, my God. It was packed.
All day.
Yeah, yeah. But my damn PTSD kicked in. All them young niggas with no masks. I'm sitting around like, oh, no. I said, you know what? I'm going to let y'all have this.
I'm about out gracefully because it ain't worth it.
How long did you stay?
All right. Initially, they was telling people to get there. We went out there with the artist we work with. Shout out Hydra the Goat, Westside on, you know. We went out there with we got about 7 o'clock. But we got there, looked like people had been there all day, like camped out. So, you know, I'm like, damn, what is this? Cause I didn't know what the hell we was coming to. We just trying to support him.
Right.
You know, so we get there and all these country looking folks. I mean, I none gets cut, but it's a whole lot of folks just out there, just everywhere.
Right.
Allegedly. You know what I'm saying? By 9 o'clock, like I got out of the car. I sat there to let them, you know, because it was like a line. They were letting the artists in. They was waiting for other people. It was hectic. But I ain't gonna say it was unorganized because I'm sure the people who put it on got their money.
Right.
You know, so I guess it's how they set it up.
Right. Okay.
You know, but it appeared if you were standing out there waiting trying to get in, it was unorganized like a motherfucker. But you know, I stayed there about 9. And I shot everybody deuces like, hey, I love y'all, man. You know,
yeah, because it don't seem worth it. Let me tell you something. Our interaction with people will never go back to what it was before COVID. Yeah, I don't think it will.
How can it, though?
Some of it's not really even necessary to go back to what it was before COVID.
Well,
how can it, though?
Let me tell you something. I don't think it could only because, like, you don't know. Like, we find an invisible monster here. Like, it's literally... We don't even know.
And then everybody pop up and say they got it. They had no damn symptoms. So everybody like, you had no damn symptoms.
Right.
No cough, no sneeze, no motherfucking sore throat. So you standing there doing the comedy show, just file the fuck out.
Yeah. And think about all the conversations you really had, though, with people who said, oh, I had it in September, October, before they told us about it.
Exactly.
I think what they're talking about is definitely what I already had.
Yeah.
But when you went in there to that doctor and you got that CPAC or whatever, they didn't have listed as one of their illnesses, COVID.
Right.
It was they didn't even know.
It was a cold. It was the flu.
Yeah, like they didn't. They had no idea. So that's what's really rude.
I feel great now.
Right.
right. But that's the part that's kind of scary, because at this point, at first I was like, okay, let's listen to the scientists. You know what I'm saying? Like that was my whole thing. Like, we got to listen to the scientists. But then when the scientists started kind of
this one I know was bullshit.
Don't trust me.
Look,
I'm like, are you sure?
Look, this one I know was some bullshit. When they said, okay, first they was like, you get a little cough, sore throat. Then they say, you get tests. Then they say, well, you don't have to have no symptoms. Mm-hmm. I'm like, so naturally you want everybody to be scared of everybody. So now everybody got these mad. Anybody cough somewhere, everybody now trying to keep from coughing and shit, you know.
Yeah.
I take my mask off for cough. You know, just naturally, because I don't want to cough my goddamn mask.
Why,
put my mask down. Like, everybody like, motherfucker, what is this? And I thought about it, I said, oh, okay.
Right.
I mean, we went to an event on Saturday that we live streamed, and they had everybody spread out 6 feet apart in the chairs, and everybody had on masks. You had to have on masks to even get in the space.
What kind of event was it?
It was actually a memorial service.
It was a going home.
Yeah,
service.
Memorial.
Oh, okay.
Well, I went to.
It wasn't a funeral. It was a memorial service.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
It was the same way. I went to a funeral, actually, Friday. We had a cousin pass, aunt pass, but, and that's how they was. They had social distancing.
Yeah,
and
they
like
had social distancing like a mug. You had to wear a mask to get in there. You had to wear a mask to, you were required to wear masks. Some people tried to get away with it. Like the audio guy, he didn't have no mask on. But the lady kept coming in looking at him like, nigga.
Right.
You better not call for nothing in this book.
It should be like that.
The guy or the man, I'm not going to say the guy, the man that passed from COVID. Mm-hmm. But check this out. He got COVID, didn't really know it, went home, gave it to his wife. So after George died 2 months ago, he still had it, was in the hospital, came home, and then he just passed.
See, that's the scary part about that right there.
Within two, three months?
From COVID.
With James Brown, but he's also a part of Wayfield Foods.
Yeah, and he's part of Wayfield Foods.
Because Wayfield CEO came to the thing.
See, that's the tragic part about that, man.
Yeah, like that is just so sad, man, because this is my thing. Like, I promise y'all, we are fighting an invisible demon, and we honestly don't know which way it's coming. And to think that you could hurt your family, like,
hey man, you can tell them Negroes that on Bankhead yesterday. God, it was so many niggas on Bankhead yesterday.
Did y'all see the people? Yes, I looked at somebody's live video. I would have been a nervous wreck.
I was on Mooly live video.
Yeah, that's why I seen it.
Let me tell you something.
I said, what Mooly mask at? Where's your mask? I said, where's your mask?
Oh, I
did send him a request, and I will make him know I sent him.
But yeah, they was live and loaded on Backhand.
Yes.
We'll make sure that one get correct.
right. But let me tell you something. The way my nerves are set up, a crowd full of people.
That shit out.
Well, I think we gotta understand too, you know, it's real generational in how we moving out there right now. Right?
Yeah.
Me and my partners, we ask ourselves, if we was 20, 21, 22, how would we be moving?
Right.
We hope we would have common sense and move rational, but right now it's such a fear factor that you don't really know what's going on, man.
21, and, I was like,
right.
Coming who?
Right. But that's where I'm going with the conversation. When you see them, we making those you know, opinions or those perceptions based on some folks in our early, you know, late 30s, early 40s.
That's true.
And we're talking about this young crew out here, man. They already like, they don't believe the hype.
Right.
They don't believe the smoke or the leaders who up there telling us.
Right.
So that's true.
Why you want me to believe just randomly?
Right.
Ain't nobody passed in my circle.
Right.
That's how they thinking, you know, so we can look at them. I mean, we can cringe And they still out there moving, but until it affects them,
they have no clue.
It won't affect them.
I got it.
Oh, baby, I could not imagine.
Whole nother life.
I just couldn't.
A new norm.
Yes.
A new norm.
And see, that's the thing. This is a part of our new norm. So, and I'm going to tell you something. Raising young adults. Okay, so when everything first started out in, like, March, right after you all's birthday. Yeah, because it was right before my birthday. When everything hit off, my kids was on board. They was like, oh, mama, yeah, Dun-Dun, go to the store. Like, we had appointed Adonis to go to the store every go-round. He the one get the gas. He the one that was going to take the risk. Mama, if something happened to me, I went out in style. You know, so we had a book. Like, oh, we had all this stuff together for, like, 2 months. Right. He did this stuff. And then one day, I don't know. It was like, mama, we can't take it no more. We out the house, mama.
No, we ain't scared no more.
We ain't scared no more, mama. We got to get up out of here. But they did so good for so long. And I was like, well, just don't come in my room then.
Right.
So they was like, well, what we'll do is, so here they go. This was their remedy. Well, when we come in the house, we'll go up the steps through the kitchen. Mm. We ain't gonna come around the other side by your room. Cause I'm like, I'm social distancing. You know, I'm thinking, I'm like, I'm not about to get, y'all not gonna make me sick. I'm the only one that was working in my office, so I could still go to work.
Right.
You know, so I'm like, no, y'all ain't gonna make me sick. And then they was just like, mama, we don't know what's going on at this point. Like, maybe like a month ago, they were just like, this is all crazy.
Right.
Like, at this point, we don't
point,
know.
Everybody didn't know what was going on.
Yeah, they like, we don't know what to believe. We don't know what's going on. Like, as much as we want to research ourselves, we keep coming up with the same answers. So it's like, as a mother, I'm just winging it.
What can you tell them, right?
Right, because it's like we're all learning at the same time. But I have expressed to them, you know, like being out in the open with all of those people is too dangerous. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. What about clubbing?
What about who?
Clubbing.
Clubbing. Mm-hmm. They ain't really clubbers anyway. Mm-hmm. Like.
Not yet. They don't know the value of the club yet.
they ain't really clubbers. Like they.
And I think, I think with the clubs, you know, the clubs to even taking a risk. As
man,
it relates
what?
To the liability of allowing groups or just a number of people to come in there. Uh-huh. You know, it's hard, but again, on the back end, you thinking about that loan
revenue.
You probably just took. You thinking about how you gonna pay what you already owe to these new loans.
You know what
you're
gonna think about?
Like
we can sacrifice a couple folks, we get this crowd up here.
That business pays for your own personal bills.
Yeah, that's the thing. Right. And that makes sense.
They had to move to another
area. And they had to clean that area. Yeah. It only made sense. But when it comes to the clubs, like the clubs, they have been jam-packed.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
All of them.
Oh,
a lot of people have been
waiting.
I was just about to say that they have been waiting to club. They've been waiting to go shopping. Like, at 40... I'm just at a point where none of that is important to me, but I know to some people that's how they live.
Hey, well, how you catch COVID, man? I was up in the club, man, and I guess I caught it from homegirl Booty Juice, cause she would give me a tap dance and a lap dance,
and I didn't even know that nigga that passed me that blunt.
Right. And you like, what? At 40, you know how crazy that sounds? We like,
what you say though?
Right. I ain't even know it.
I can't. I'm not.
We were having a good time.
It's not worth it. How old is he? Oh, okay.
Oh,
wow.
Went back twice.
Right, and so you think
nobody
But you think about the how many people he was around before somebody even suggested that he get it done. Yeah, so that's but that's what I'm saying. That's why I said at this point we just gotta work on ourselves, and you know what I'm saying, and try to seriously build our immune system up just in case it come, like, at least be, because see, that's the thing. You don't, of course you all know, you don't die from COVID. You die from the symptoms and, you know, all the stuff that's surrounded or whatever. Yeah, so you just want, I mean, honestly, I'm at this point, I want to be strong enough to just kind of fight it, because I don't know. I went into Quick Trip last week and almost fainted. I was like, girl, it's people in there eating hot dogs from the spinner. Like, yeah. I was just over it. Yeah.
People are really out there moving. Mm-hmm. People are really out there moving like it's not a new day.
Right. That's what I'm saying.
They're really out there moving like it was the same way it was last year.
Look here. I'm tiptoeing. And these people are, they loose as a goose. And I'm like,
hey, man, no.
Before COVID, I knew I'm not real good.
Yeah, I was going to say the same thing. I was real.
I had crowd anxiety.
I was real particular about a lot of stuff. Grabbing napkins before I grab what you grab. Going to the restaurants.
Yeah. I'm getting stuff out the back when I go to the grocery store. Just
I could be wrong, but I really do feel like that's our generation is like that. Because we like that too. We'd be like, don't get the first one. We got to go a little further. You know, like.
Because we've had those examples.
Right.
But we've seen people take losses
right.
and they didn't have to.
Right.
They took those losses because of preparation
right.
and not being prepared about it.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah, no, seriously. And I think that's a part of our generation, seriously, because we certain things come to mind with us when we're shopping and when there's certain things like going on. Whereas of course as young adults we probably weren't as cautious. But these young people now.
And if I could hit add on to it, you know, even thinking about how COVID is, you know, just chaotically terrorizing us right now, even for the young people or whomever, even at home that's confided, that can't get out, you got people harming each other in their own families, man.
Absolutely.
You know, mentally and, you know, physically, because it's something that they can't deal with. This is something that nobody even have to even prepare for, having to have confrontations with your stepdad or your dad or your mom or your brothers. Yeah. They like, no, you can't go out. He or she like, yeah, I'm gone.
All right.
I'm coming back home.
Right.
You know, so at that point it's kind of hard, man. You got to really just pray and just have faith and come to something different where you could just, you know, you teach your kids. And you expect them and you hope that they follow some of your ways.
Right.
When they become of age, they're going to move how they want to move anyway.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to die, and there's going to be a lot of things they'll never tell you that they've been a part of.
Right. That's true.
But as it relates to that, what's happening internally in our community, in our houses right now, man, you got a lot of infighting. Mm-hmm. You got people taking L's in the house, and they got nothing to do with COVID.
Right.
It's got to do with that mental health, man, and people taxing on one another, and we got to come up with a better way to just deal with each other.
And property management, and I mentioned this months ago, how the domestic violence rate increased so much, right? And it wasn't just couples. It, like you said, it was kids. It was just so much going on. My office is in the one-bedroom unit. Let me just say that. I'm right by the one-bedroom units. And a lot of those people are on different work schedules. They were. So sometimes one will be coming in the morning. Some will be leaving out. You know, like, it was, everybody had their schedule. Mm-hmm. When they put us on lockdown, I promise you, I used to call my brother and be like, the police out here again.
Right.
Like, I mean, this was, I'm serious. Mm-hmm. I would be like, I could hear them hollering and screaming. I'm like, what is going on? Now, my office is still closed, but I'm still there working. So I'm like, what is going on? When I finally had a chance to
having
to
arrests
talk
around
to,
each other.
Yeah, when I talked to the police and the police officer, he was just like, Donald, he was like, these people have never had to be around each other. Seriously, like no longer than like a day.
Right.
Maybe. And then they still had the option of leaving, going somewhere.
Right.
He was like, man, he said, we had so many, and I'm in Cobb County. They don't want to arrest anybody because of COVID, but they also don't want to keep answering these domestic calls and dealing with mental illness because of the same reason. So it's like, okay, at what point? Yeah, so like, it's mentally wearing on these officers as well.
It's they don't want to be the officer to come to the house and then they don't respond and they come back the next day and something tragic has happened.
Right.
They don't want to be that one.
Exactly. So it's kind of you know, it's a lot going on mentally with everybody really. So that's why I always try to speak life into people, regardless of your situation, regardless of whatever it is you have. I always try to speak life into people because you don't even know. You might be the last person that they have an encounter with before they go and do something. Like, so you just never know. So the one thing that I can honestly say, people have been a lot nicer in public. Right. You know, I don't know what they're doing all the time behind closed doors, but in public, I can see a difference with the way some people, you know, kind of interact with you, or, you know, even behind the mask sometimes, you know, even eye contact, stuff like all of that matters. So my goal, my personal goal, because even mentally with me, it affects me. So I know Absolutely. It affects my children.
Absolutely.
So it's like my personal goal is to just kind of speak life. Like, even like when my children get discouraged, I'm like, look, it could be so much different. Just think about it this way. And they'd be like, yeah, man, you're right. So I try to keep them, you know, keep their mind going. And then I have other people that's nice enough to keep my mind going.
Right.
Cause it's I'm telling you, it's wearing and tearing on everybody. So it's kind of like, at this point, we have to find. I don't know, as far as getting mental help. Like, if you don't have anybody to talk to, if you don't feel comfortable talking to somebody, look here, book you an appointment.
People don't realize how just talking to somebody really helps. Yeah. They're like, I ain't putting nobody in my business. But actually,
you better.
Actually, you have to figure out some way to get that off your mind.
Yeah, my mic on. See, look. What?
Well, some black people, I'll say that. Because I believe in therapy.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I've always been, even as when my children were little, I always believed in that. Because sometimes children will tell somebody something that they don't, you know, like they'll tell somebody that they don't really know
something that they won't tell you
because they're afraid you may be mad at them. Or say, for instance, if it's anything dealing with, because most people that comfort children or attack children or do things to children, a lot of times they do put their parents in it. I kill your mama. I kill your daddy if you tell them.
Right.
So they don't want to tell you because they don't want you to die. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's just their mind. They don't understand that their daddy could beat this person up or their daddy could shoot this person or do something to this. They just don't want their daddy to leave or their mama to leave them, period.
Thinking it's their fault.
Right. So they will talk to a therapist.
Oh, I mean, I think any outlet to express yourself, and it doesn't have to really even be about speaking to somebody that you don't know or you do know. Right now, it's the information age. You can go online and you can read positive inspiration.
Mm-hmm.
You can pull up on YouTube positive inspiration. You can come in to, you know, the Westside Misfits and listen in to get positive inspiration.
That's
so
right.
So what I'm saying, I mean, you don't really have to pay no copay to go and have no conversation. I really don't believe that. I mean, to somebody that don't know you. If you don't have friends, you can find outlets. And that's the thing where we got to push, just making an awareness in our community. There's so many resources and outlets, but we always quick to serve for that profit instead of serving for service.
Right.
You know, we got to be more service-oriented in our mindsets as opposed to being profit-generated. Yeah. You know, the profit moves it, but if we become more service-oriented, you'll start thinking about other ways to be creative where you can target an audience and where you can go in there and actually speak to them where they can receive what they're saying and not feel like they're getting beat up all the time, where it's not an end game. It's not a dollar symbol behind it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's at this point, and that's kind of why I felt like I've been on the sideline for a while, I'm going to tell you. And Mooley and a lot of my friends, they, you know, been asking me to be involved, but I had other personal things that I was dealing with in my own life and in my own house that I felt like I had to get that in order before I could provide, you know, feed or meat to the streets or just anybody in general.
Mm-hmm.
But I definitely believe, you know, it's nothing wrong with it. It's just like a doctor. I tell you the same thing. We go to doctors when we're feeling ill.
Mm-hmm.
It can be, they ask us, what's your rating? Is it from 1 to 10?
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can have a conversation with somebody. Mm-hmm. What's your rating? How you feeling?
That's true.
Come in on some of these podcasts and chop it up. Have a conversation.
But some people feel like, especially in our community, feel like going to counseling or talking to somebody about your problems is weak.
You're weak. Yeah.
And you're supposed to be able to, you know what I'm saying, overcome whatever's bothering you.
Well, I think too, the media drives those kinds of things. Mm-hmm. And when they drive those kinds of messages, it just creates conflict and confusion in the community. Right. It ain't really about them feeling weak. It's just that you done told me this for 30, 40 years. It's, so now I'm going to receive that.
Right. Yeah, because you think about it, say for instance, if you tell yourself something long enough, you start to believe it, right?
Yeah.
So that's why sometimes when you know a person and you kind of see that what they're saying, you know, that's not related to how they are. It's kind of like, okay, what happened? But it's the sense of the more you don't tell yourself this, now it's a part of who you are.
You start believing.
It's power in the tongue.
It's power in the tongue.
Yeah, and that's why you have to be extremely careful. Yeah, that's why, I always tell my children that, like, one time one of my kids was like, man, I hate you. I hope you fail the CRCT. So the other one.
What?
So I'm like, first of all, I was like, first of all, you can't use hate in here.
Right.
You ain't never heard nobody say they hate them.
Yeah.
And you definitely don't wish that your sister don't pass the CRCT knowing y'all asses need each other in the same grade next year. And my mom was like, Donna, first of all, I'm gonna need you to get your children together, because what kind of drone is that? I was like, mama, look, they a little out of touch.
Right.
She was like, who wished that they sister failed the CRCT. I said, I don't know where that came from. But the whole point of the matter is, you cannot say that. She was like, okay.
Yeah.
And I'm like, exactly, because that was only like, 9 or 10? So I started them off early. Yeah, they've been studying for 2 years.
Yeah, so she like, I hope you fail. Right.
Well, I mean, think about it in your relationships or in your business.
Right.
You pissed off with a person, anything come out.
Yeah,
you ain't thinking brother, sister, cousin, uncle, husband, wife.
You cannot. Let me tell you something. Because you will always remember how a person make you feel.
Right.
And I always take that into consideration. Like, me and my brothers don't have to agree on everything. But as far as being respectful and expressing ourselves, like, I don't agree with that. Like, I still respect how they feel.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see it.
What you mean, like, fall out?
We ain't
know.
We ain't know fell out.
I ain't
no
fell out.
I don't know.
He got mad at me one time. I wore a pair of his new drawers.
He was heated.
He wanted to kill me.
I think that was but this is the thing. We don't never see Jasper upset or angry.
Yeah,
I don't know if he even, I think he probably do get upset and angry. Just not with us. I don't know.
He wanted to kill me by the
drawers.
But
but that one time when he wore his brand new underwear, he was so mad. He was like, that's disrespectful. Like,
and he had been saving him.
Yes.
Hey.
I understand the pain. I'll buy some new underwear, and I put them in the closet in the corner, and look at them like, yeah, well, I break them things out right there. Yeah.
Hey, look, I almost got away with it. I would have got away with it, but I almost forgot I had them on. And they took my damn pants off. And then he was looking at me like this.
He said, man, am I drunk?
right. And it's like,
oh my God.
Yeah. But like, we don't, I think it's because of how much respect we have for each other, seriously. Because even with my friends, though, there are certain things that I respect how my friends feel. Like, I do. I really do. Even in relationships, I respect how my mate feel. Like, so it's certain things I'm going to stay away from. I'm not, like, I don't know. It's just certain things that I'm going to stay away from. That's the only thing I don't really attract that in men.
Mm-hmm.
It's so weird because, like, I remember I dated somebody one time, and they used to have temper tantrums. Yes. But, like, they would text. Yes, a grown man would text, like, 80 texts. But all along was so crazy. I'd be like, oh, hell no. Like, this ain't going to work. So I had to learn how to let him down easy. Like, bro, I'm not finna deal with you. But I couldn't say it like that, of course, because, right, you know, I ain't really want him to come back.
No, I'm shout message.
Yeah.
Let him down easy.
Look here, my Uncle Garrett taught me a long time ago, you have to let him down easy, Pookie guy. All of that roughness, don't do that. So, yeah, but I was just, I think back to him. Even now, I can talk to him, like, we be on social media together, but he'll tell you, he'll be like, man, like, you really for real taught me how, like, I just can't say that. Because I was like, dude, are you serious? Like, I mean, I promise you, if I still had those text messages, y'all would be like, Donna, what you do to him? I could have easily just
Please
said.
Please don't say no text messages.
I would just be like, no, I'm not, we can't go out tonight. I got work early in the morning, or, you know, I'm doing something with the kids. And I guess he didn't know how to accept no. I don't really know how that go.
Well, it was a problem of you probably said yes earlier, and then now you saying no. And he's like, what the fuck? What you got going on that you got? You change your mind? What nigga you going to see? I know you got something going on.
But I think that's flaky. Yeah, you do that too, huh,
Lab? I don't do that, but I'll let me tell you something about me. I'm already going, when I start thinking about stuff, and that's why I have to go talk to people and write stuff in my journal, because I start thinking about stuff.
Yeah.
And it'll take me a few hours to ruin
rabbit
my day.
Hole, yeah.
Like, really?
Like a whole back avenue. And then once I start thinking about it, and I start thinking about it, and I start thinking about it, and I start coming up with my own scenarios, and then if I ask you about it, and then you don't say nothing or don't clarify a little bit, I already came up with my decision. I said, okay. It's a bunch of bullshit right here.
Well,
and by that time, it's too late. I already went down the rabbit hole.
Let me tell you.
I'm just telling you the truth.
So you just like this guy?
But I won't send you no texts about the shit.
What
I'm going to sit
do?
There and stew about it, and I'm going to think about it, and I'm going to think about
but
it.
But eventually, you're going to say something?
No, not really.
Well, see, let me tell you.
What?
That's the good thing, though. Being able to self-evaluate yourself.
I know
and realize
your
weaknesses and your strengths.
I'll tell you in a minute.
That's
you got people out here moving. You got people out here really moving that don't have the ability to self-evaluate.
Oh, that's true. I know that I do. I know that I will. I start thinking about some shit, and I'll be like, why that motherfucker say that? And then I'll be like, well, 3 weeks ago, they said such and such. Oh, that's why they said that.
See,
that's
a lie. Let me tell you something. You just like that guy. And to this, like, he for real be thanking me, though, because, like, he in a relationship now.
Mm-hmm.
And he'll just hit me up and be like, man, I appreciate you because, you know, this happened or that happened. And I be laughing because I always feel like any man that I date, I always make them better for somebody else.
But
and I don't have no problem with
but
that.
But you know, the funny thing about me is I wasn't really like that
until
while I was married. But once I got married and started, when I got married, when I was married for those 25 years, I didn't think none of that. I didn't think that way at all. I was like, everything was rosy, good, whatever. During the marriage, once I found out that she was cheating on me with several people, that I started saying, well, maybe I needed to start thinking about this stuff a little bit more than just not going with what somebody tell me. Because I'm thinking they love me, I love them.
That's messed
up. They're not
going to
fuck with me like that. So,
took it for granted.
Right, I just took it for granted. You get what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So I started saying, well, maybe I should have thought about what was said to me earlier. Maybe I should have listened to what they said when her and her girlfriend were talking about stuff or this and that. And I wasn't doing that.
So you
I was
let
just
her
like,
change who you were.
Well, it wasn't a fact of changing who I was. It was the fact that I needed to be more aware of my surroundings and who I'm dealing with. If I'm seeing, like you always say, there's always signs. I never saw the signs. So now that I knew that I didn't see the signs
because
before.
You were in love.
Now
you exactly, but that's the thing. That's why I said she changed who you were, because if you're looking for something, you're going to find it.
No. He's saying he's more aware of different things.
What was going on now, because I wasn't aware.
And I get what you're saying.
You have to be aware of it. Yeah. You have to be aware of it. You have to be aware of the fact that you can't be so in love with a person that you don't think that they're going to do something to hurt you.
This is the thing
right here.
You
wasn't thinking negative.
All I was thinking about was, I love her. I know I ain't going to do nothing to hurt her. So I know for a fact she loved me. She ain't going to do nothing to hurt me. I took that part for granted.
You just saying you thought you knew her better than you did.
Right. You know what I'm saying? I was thinking, well, we together, everything we do is together. We built each, you know, we went to school, college. I paid for her college. We did everything together as a band group or duo. So I'm not thinking to look for any signs because Who gonna do it better than I do it? Who gonna make sure you good like I make sure you good? Who gonna make sure she good? I'm good like she do. You know what I'm saying? But at the same, so my thing was I wasn't visualizing or expecting or even looking or even, didn't even care about any of that stuff because I just knew for a fact.
But you still shouldn't.
But now you saying, but I changed because I do now.
But that's my whole point.
I expect now let me just put it this way: instead of not expecting the bullshit, I expect the bullshit, and when it happens, I'm more prepared for it. When it doesn't, I'm like, oh, okay, cool. I expect the bullshit. I wasn't expecting nothing. I wasn't expecting.
But Lab, you think about it. You think about it. You put people at a disadvantage who trying to that are genuine people. That's trying to deal with you and
not necessarily.
Yes, you do.
Let me tell you why though. Let me tell you why. Just by you being more aware, it's like something happened to you one time, but before it happened to you that first time, you were never looking for it. But see, after it happened to you one time, so now you realize it was signs that happened before that you just kind of let slide.
Or didn't even.
You weren't aware of.
Because they weren't signs. Okay, so let me give you an example.
You gotta live and learn.
I understand what you're saying. But what I'm saying is it kind of builds a wall, right? So you're expecting for something to happen. So the smallest thing that a person do, you're okay with it because you expected them to be some bullshit anyway. But that's unfair to them because you can't expect for somebody to know what you're expecting. Like it's kind of weird.
How is it unfair to them if I expect bullshit and they do some bullshit?
Well, I think it's like you're going
because
into
they doing it anyway.
But you're going into it with a negative mindset.
That's not necessarily.
I'm going into it with a more aware outlook.
Well, you can be more aware because you got an example. You got a living example of 25 years.
Right.
And at the end of that, you took a test. You basically took a test.
Right.
And throughout that test of 25 years, you had some A's in there.
Right.
But toward the end of that 24th, 25th,
like
you was failing.
Yeah.
So that's an example. That's growth and development.
But you get what you expect, though. See, that's the only thing I'm saying.
That's not true because I was expecting the best. I was expecting the most wonderful things in America and the world could offer. But I did not get that.
So have you ever heard of putting things out into the universe and manifesting, right?
I get that. And I was putting out the most wonderfulest things ever.
Guess what though? But even I understand what you're
saying. Continue being you.
Continue
and don't
being
let her
that
change
person
who
that's,
you are
that's,
as a person.
That's continuously pushing.
I don't think I'm changed as a person as far as who I am when I'm with somebody and what I'm going to do and do. All I'm saying is I'm a little bit more aware of my surroundings. You get what I'm saying? I'm a little bit more aware that
he just ain't finna get hit with that bullshit
no more. I
just can't
expect people to, let me tell you like this, I can't expect people to treat me like I would treat them. I can't expect people to be me.
You cannot.
You get what I'm saying?
You cannot.
But I expected that before. I can't.
Oh,
you get what
okay,
I'm saying?
Yeah.
If I'm doing this,
yeah,
then they gonna do this. If I'm treating them like this, they gonna treat me like this. I can't expect. Exactly. I never
And
knew.
I can believe that, but let me tell
and
you
I
something.
And I wasn't looking for it.
But even through that experience, though, you have to think about what you got out of it.
Right.
And I'll be honest with you, because a lot of times we can't, like, it's all about, sometimes it's all about perception. Yeah, it didn't work, you know, it wasn't you, though.
Right.
So even.
Oh, I'm the
Whatever, but I'm just saying though, because you know sometimes we start discounting ourselves when the other person don't value us or don't see what we feel like they should see. We'll start devaluing ourselves, and then we'll start, okay, I could have did this different. Yes, yeah, gonna always be a way that you could have done something different, but you can't.
I think I did everything right.
And
whatever.
Let me
but
tell
I
you
think
something.
People got to feel failing anyway.
Right, right.
I think
you
people
never
just got to
fail.
Failing.
You never want to fail at something that you're putting your all into.
Yeah.
And I was putting my all into that relationship, so it wasn't like it was ever. Let me
I
tell you.
It was never supposed to. Like it was your marriage.
And I would do that if another marriage. You get what I'm saying? I would do that. And it's not like my next marriage. If I get married to somebody else, I'm going to give them any less of what I gave that person.
Yeah.
The point I'm trying to make is I can't expect my new wife or whoever I marry in the future to be me.
Yeah.
I can't expect him to do as I would do. I can't expect him, like, if somebody wants to, if they want to go and do something and do whatever they want to do, and I wouldn't do certain things, I can't expect them to do that because they're not me.
And you're absolutely right. That's why.
Even if it's disrespectful to me, I still can't expect them to do it.
Okay, so it's because it's kind of like you're right about that. Because the thing about it is that's why you have to do things from the heart. And the main reason you do, because you don't, if it doesn't go the way you feel it should go, then you know you did what you were supposed to do. Mm-hmm. You ain't got anything to do with what happened. Like, I did what I felt was the best thing to do. Yeah, so that's just like when you, just say for instance, when you, it's kind of how you buy a person a gift. Mm-hmm. You buy them a gift and went for their birthday, and then for your birthday, they don't even tell you happy birthday.
Right.
Mm. And it's like, damn, I bought them a whole gift. They ain't even going to acknowledge my birthday. But in actuality, I'll be honest with you, you couldn't expect for them to tell you happy birthday just because you bought them a gift because you did that. Right. They ain't asked you to.
Right, right.
You know, so I could get
that. You don't even know if they know when your birthday.
Right.
That's a good example. I can't expect. Like, if I would go out and do something that I know that would hurt their feelings and not, I won't do it. But I can't expect them to do that because they're not me.
Mm. Right.
That's all I'm saying. I'm not saying that I expect the bullshit. All I expect them, all I know now is that I can't expect me out of the person that I'm with.
I absolutely agree with that.
Just let it go on. And if it don't work out, kick rocks. Somebody else will, you know what I'm saying, respect me a little bit more. Yeah.
So, then if that so person Mike, don't, how,
I can't kick rocks too.
How long have you been married?
17 years.
Wow, it's been that long?
Been that long.
Well, yeah. Time don't play.
That's right.
Yeah. So that, oh my goodness, man.
And I was going to add on it, you know, it's just about like you went through a period and you thought out of loyalty and just that it wouldn't happen.
Exactly.
Because we oftentimes, we want to believe that everybody was raised how we was raised.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Want to be everybody got the same morals and morals and culture and values and beliefs as we have, and we don't. Right. People that we love don't think like we think.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So you got to come to a common ground oftentimes to compromise.
Right.
And in compromising, you get to really evaluate your partner. Mm-hmm. Or your friend,
mm-hmm.
or that person you're working with. Mm-hmm. You know, it don't happen. You know, in the beginning, everything is picket fences and roses.
Right.
You know
what I'm saying? Right.
Everything is real sweet.
Yeah.
We having fun. Right. We go out and kick it. So when you sit down and chop it and have those real heart-to-heart conversations, you get to learn about a person's values, their beliefs, what they feel about family, what they feel about race, what you feel about manhood, what you feel about womanhood, you know, what you feel about kids. Mm. People ain't talking about that before they say I do.
And
that's the disconnect. It happens on the back end.
And you should be discussing this stuff. That gap needs to be bridged. And that's why I believe in marriage counseling, because I honestly believe during counseling, those are some of the things that will come up. Even if it's only for a few sessions, those are some of the things that you want to address. Let me tell you something. In the way that the climate is now, it is probably really, really hard on, with couples that are like interracial couples. Like at this point, because you think about it, you attracted. I'm a black woman. I attracted this black man, this white man. I don't know what I really did to attract him. But it felt good. It felt like it was okay.
Mm-hmm.
And now that we're in the climate of where we are now, we've been married, I'll just say 10 years. We've been married 10 years, and race ain't never even really came up.
Right.
It ain't never really paid. You know, it has never really made the forefront for our marriage because guess what? I attracted him. He liked me. It didn't matter. But now it's having to be discussed. So now... Yeah. Yeah, and exactly.
You got a lot of people who really, it goes back again, thinking that everybody grew up the same way.
Right.
You know, because we grew up on the west side of Atlanta, and that's all we saw was us. Right. We don't know how they grew up, you know, in Beaufort
mm-hmm.
or in Buckhead, where they had a little bit more diversity.
Right.
Where you sat next to, you sat in class next to you know, somebody that was of a different color than you.
Right.
And what you got now is our kids out there in high school and grade school, mm-hmm. where they totally disconnected to what's going on.
Right.
They like, my best friend is white.
Right.
My best friend is black. So how are you telling me all this? So now they going back, looking at mom and grandma, like, y'all been making stuff up?
Right.
Y'all been lying to me?
It's
a disconnect because you're trying to define something that they never had to really talk about. And many times, oftentimes, if you think about even outside of just, you know, we're in Atlanta, but you think about other places, Texas or mm-hmm. Boston or other places mm-hmm. where you grew up and it was a lot of whites and blacks going to school together. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But we'll question them on why they interracially fell in love with each other,
right.
Because we can't relate.
Right.
We can't relate to no experiences that them folks done had.
That's true. Hey, mm-hmm. everybody on Facebook, tune in. What's up, everybody? Hey, family. We ain't forgot about y'all.
We have
not been looking at the comments. My name's Show. What's up, bro? Happy Father's Day to you.
That's right.
Happy Father's Day, everyone.
Gino Late. Happy Father's Day. I don't know if that's a guy. Happy Father's Day to you too, bro. Everybody tune in. We just not reading the comments. We apologize. Tarted to our head, not our heart.
Right. We're in here having us a very engaging conversation, and I love when we have shows like this because it allows people to kind of get to know, just kind of get to know us and get to know our character. Mm. And when it, like we was talking about with the interracial marriages, right? Mm. So
that, I mean, like in Atlanta, like growing up, we get confused. We grew up in this utopia that we thought everything was just like, cause we went to school with all black people. We had mostly all black teachers, so we didn't, we just dealt with stuff around here. So we never, and we used to wonder like how kids up in Gwinnett and different places, like we never deal with that.
Right.
So we never had to deal with that.
And we did that in Chicago. Yeah. I mean, we had a little, I didn't see any diversity difference from in my neighborhood until I went to high school, because in Chicago you could go to any high school you wanted to, you just had to get there as long as it was in the city.
Oh, okay, as long as it was in the city. Like,
so I went to a high school in Ravenswood, which I took the bus to, where it was Indian, white, Spanish, Latino. Uh-huh. It was a whole smorgasbord of students within that school. Mm. So Lane Tech was within that school. So I went to Lane Tech, which was, it was real diverse because Lane Tech was like Chinese kids, mm-hmm. everybody was there.
Right.
So I didn't see that diversity until I went to school, to high school, but during grammar school, grammar school was all one because we went from kindergarten to eighth grade in one school in Chicago. So we didn't go to no middle school. So
we didn't go to middle school. But you think about it, you think about how it is for social media. So today, with the generation today, they have social media. It's hard for a lot of the white kids to be racist because a lot of their favorite people are black.
Right.
So it's hard for them to just kind of be like, I hate them because they black. Like
a different kind though. Like certain things, like I don't think a lot of white parents are, put like this, they, it's certain way they handle certain situations that show their kids who they are. Or certain statements. You don't necessarily have to tell your kids to look down on somebody else for being another race, but they watch how you interact with other races and say certain things. You get what I'm saying?
But the older they get, this is what I'm saying. With social media being as popular and as like a part of so many children's lives now, it's hard for them to see or deal with their parents being mean or saying something disrespectful mm-hmm. to somebody that look like their favorite people only because of their skin color. Right. And it's like, mom, do you know them? And your mom says no. Then it's like, well, hey, you say that for them. You know what I'm saying? So now it's like, okay, now they're taking notes. Yeah. Because social media is bridging these gaps, and that's why now you can see so many videos on social media where a lot of the white kids are like, okay, we're a part of the generation that's gonna stop.
A lot of
this.
Them are realizing that their parents don't know shit.
Yeah,
or their parents are confused. Like that one girl was on
there,
she was just like, I just figured out my goddamn parents are morons. Like, what in the hell is
happening?
And it's happening. But that's what they're breaking down right now.
Yeah.
And what's hurting the parents and the grandparents is that they feel like the mask is off. Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
And they feel like they can ride that way for so long. Mm-hmm. But we can't even, we got to even look at it in our own communities.
Mm-hmm.
Our own communities and our grandparents and great-grandparents were so, so hurt and tarnished because of the stuff that they dealt with.
That's
that
right.
They had some rage in them too.
Absolutely.
I don't fool with them.
Right.
No, y'all can't go over there because They ain't gonna treat you right.
Right. See, this is the thing. They didn't want. Let me tell you. So they had been discriminated. I feel like with our older generation, they had been discriminated and made to feel so bad about certain stuff. They didn't want us to feel that. Right.
They didn't want to feel that pain.
So they just like don't even go over there.
Don't even do it.
Don't go there. Like instead of like schooling us, letting us know certain stuff. It was just, you can't do it. Because, you know, we didn't question our grandparents and stuff. It was like, shit, grandma said we couldn't do it.
We respected them.
Right. So we didn't do it. Right. Out of respect, we just didn't do it. Right. But where those generations kind of failed us at was not really letting us know some of the stuff that they'd endure. Like, a lot of that stuff I know for them was embarrassing, you know, and it was like, just know it happened, you know, I just don't want y'all to ever feel like that, so just disregard it altogether. But I feel like if a lot of our older generation had just kind of told us some stuff, that it would have made us a little bit different and more compassionate too towards some of the things that they were lacking or that they needed. Right. And we're thinking they being mean, but it wasn't that.
Right.
It was just that they've gone through so much. It's kind of like
they were being protected.
They were being protected. So it gets down to the generations, though. These new generations now, like I was telling them, like, they're not coming in peace. They're trying to understand what's really going on. So they're going to ask us those uncomfortable questions. Right. They want some real answers, and it's going to be up to us to give it to them, to make sure that they're aware.
And unfortunately, we at a point and a time where we do have to sit them down and have those uncomfortable conversation that even our parents didn't.
Right.
And hope that we get it at this point, because you said it right. You know, you said that they're coming and they're pissed off.
Yeah.
But oftentimes it's because of a disconnect.
Right.
You know, and what we need is to have a conversation with them to provide like different prerequisites for them.
Absolutely.
Because we've always had activists.
That's
you know,
true.
But even with those activists who've been out there for years, it come to time where they got to pass that torch.
Oh,
but
yeah.
They got to write a blueprint for the new generation.
But that's the part we're having a disconnect with,
right,
Mike.
Right.
So, like, I've been saying this, and I know some people just be like, Donald, why? Like, the term limits.
They definitely
what are we gonna do about the term limits? Because we have senators and people representing us
that's been there forever.
We don't want them to have to die. But right now, I'll definitely say, y'all, the needle is definitely moving.
Okay.
Because I mean, again, if we think about how it was established and created,
right.
Everything got an end game. You know, whatever we doing on the front end, we forecasting what's going to happen on the back end.
Absolutely.
So when they put these processes and systems and legislations and stuff in place, they were basically saying, this is how we want to go forever.
Mm-hmm.
They weren't thinking about growth and development. They weren't thinking about change.
Right.
They don't want change. They winning.
My name show said that, going back to interracial couples, he said, mm-hmm. if it's an interracial couple, you have to understand that both these people are honestly open to other cultures and look at people as people.
Right.
He said he loves his chocolate girlfriend, but have honestly dated white, Native American, Latino, and Asian. And then Alicia Gilliam says, back then we better not have opened our mouth. We weren't allowed to question their authority, meaning
right.
our parents and what mm-hmm. they told
right.
us about
out of
certain
respect,
things
we
and
just
people.
Didn't.
Right, right. So I just want to throw those. Right.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, what basically, like Sho said, like, when you can see past somebody's color, which most times, I'll be honest with you, but black people can, though. Like, that's something we specialize in, I think, because we don't really be tripping.
We went to
when
Walmart
you ask
today,
God to send you a wife or a husband, you don't be somebody.
This lady
make sure they black.
In the Walmart, right? Went to Walmart today. Lady walked past us in Walmart, and she stopped. She said, do you got some cocoa, coconut oil on or something? And she not thinking that. She like, no, I don't. And you know, went on by her. And I said, what the hell she mean by that? She trying to say she smelled coconut oil and there must be some niggas in his eye. They must got coconut oil because you know they like all that shea butter and coconut butter and shit on with that. What she trying to say? And she like, no, that's not, I smell it too. I said, no, she meant something. She just had to stop and ask us if we had coconut oil.
Y'all got any coconut oil?
Right. But no, it gets even weirder. We're in the store. Listen, yesterday.
And
no.
She probably just didn't mean nothing by it, but I went straight to that.
Hey. Right, immediately.
That baby didn't mean nothing by it. But you, but
I went straight to it.
We defensive like that.
Right, but now we are because
we're overly sensitive.
Because
on
we're finding out so much stuff, and it's like, dang. Let me tell you something, but like, we often say, like, we're in a generation where we're raising our children and kind of learning all at the same time. Mm-hmm. This is one of the first generations that are able to do that. Like, we listen to some of their music. We're wearing some of the clothes that they wear. Like, we're the first generation to really be able to do that. And I say that because I don't even ever remember going to my mama's closet getting nothing. That being like, this is so cute, let me wear it. Like, and my kids can come demolish my closet. And I'm like, well, I'll buy you one. And they're like, nah, we'll just wear yours. So, like, I know that our generation is setting the bar for so much when it comes to, you know, parenting, when it comes to bridging the gaps with our kids. So we hold a different kind of responsibility, whether we want to or not.
And see, I say swag didn't start with them either. It started with us.
It's easy to transition into that.
No,
seriously, like that is right. So that's what I'm saying.
They made the difference, Mike.
So we're the ones.
Swag started a long time ago.
So we're the ones that's bridging this gap. Yeah. So we hold a huge responsibility as far as, like, even with careers and developing them to just become who they want to become. Right. Like, we never wanted to disappoint our parents, right? Mm-hmm. That's just something we just never wanted to do. And with our generation, we don't want our kids to disappoint us, but we also know the importance of letting them move how they need to move in order for them to be at their peak, for them to get it,
to
get what they, our... what, yeah, so. So that's what I'm saying. Like, with our generation, man, we hold a lot of responsibility. If you're anywhere between the age of, I'll just say 40 and 50, like, how you parent, how you moving is very important. How you develop your children, mm-hmm. what you're saying to them, all of that stuff is going to be really, really important. And we have to take heed to it because, believe it or not, a lot of times those disconnects start at home.
Mm-hmm. A lot of
Well, what happens is, because I can honestly say that I'm going to be honest with you. Now, my children aren't my friends, but I am their friend.
Right.
Do that make sense to you? Like, it's certain stuff I wouldn't share with my children because, like, hell no. But I want them to feel comfortable enough, you know.
But you don't tell him stuff. You know what I'm saying? Like, he tells you.
That's exactly. It's the same.
And I think it should be like that.
Yeah.
So, just like an example. Carlos
is
going to sit right here and smoke a blunt
and be like,
him,
Mom. No, definitely, no.
He ain't finna, finna drink a beer. And he 30 and be like, I'm drinking a beer. He ain't going to do that.
No, you know that's what I'm saying. That's why I say.
People are doing that. They going to the club with their church. They smoking with their church. Mm. They
drinking
with their church.
Yeah. That's true.
Well, and you know, what happens is when we see certain things or people out there moving certain ways, we know they got it from their parents.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and not to really knock their parents. You know,
we
are who we are. Like I tell people all the time, a lot of our generation was really the ones to be either some of the ones to either attempt college or even graduate from college. Mm-hmm. So at that point, we got somewhat of a blueprint that our parents probably wasn't able to set for us.
Right.
You know, they didn't have them conversations with us about really, you know, you should go be a doctor, a lawyer,
right.
a judge, mm-hmm. or a mayor, or a president, or do some of that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It's those conversations are happening with us because they're seeing it now.
Right.
They're seeing certain things where you have different people at school even coming to school where they're like legacy.
Right.
You know, they come to the Morehouse, the Spelman, mm-hmm. because their father, their mother, right. their grandfather, mm-hmm. different people went there. But there's still a group of people who were first generation to these places.
Right.
Right.
So they didn't have that blueprint written for them. So once they graduated and walked across that stage, they had a job waiting on them.
Right.
They didn't
right.
have to interview for no jobs.
Right.
Right.
They didn't have to really learn how to talk and articulate to people because they had a play already ready for
right.
them.
Right.
Some people actually had to go out there and grind and hustle and really learn to play
That's
themselves.
Right.
They were on the job training. So they took a couple of L's, they
right.
took some F's,
right.
they took some D's.
Yeah.
So by the time they, you know, got up in their career,
you know, it might have been 5, 6, 7 years later when other people was already set right because they was a part of that blueprint.
Right. Mm.
And I had that problem come out of college. I didn't have no legacy, you know, on all that stuff. So I had to work other places. And I got a master's degree, a bachelor's degree in psychology. And I'm having to go other places to work until I did find that one niche that I could continue to grow on. But
absolutely.
I didn't have no job waiting on me when I got out of college. I didn't have no bills either, but I didn't have no jobs. I had kids and stuff, but it was just, I didn't have that legacy. I didn't have a father or grandfather who knew somebody that knew somebody that had a job waiting on me when I got out of school. It didn't work that way. And a lot of kids nowadays don't have that. So they have to figure out their way and their path of how they're going to get to where
they are. And
they
don't know it until they actually get in there.
Get in there.
They
right.
don't know that these kids got plays. Some of their best friends got plays being ran for.
Right.
Yep. And they never knew.
They, don't,
they got that kicking it, wilding out, having a ball, but they all crossing that stage together.
Right.
But next thing you know, they done told you, yeah, I'm working at the firm.
Right. Right.
I'm over here at the doctor's office.
Right. And
you're like, well, damn, how you get your job so fast?
Right.
And then you find out.
You ain't doing something right.
You feel like you dropped the ball somehow.
Right.
Well, you really didn't. It's just that you got a different playbook.
That's right. But see, that and that's another thing too when it comes to
that's
social media and how
oppression.
People
that's systematic
exactly
white privilege
and that's how it works. That's why with social media you have
that
to be careful.
Place with so many different things.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. You and you have to be careful because you see these people living a certain way. Oh, this is your visual. You see them doing this. You see them doing that. And you don't like you said. You don't know what playbook they're coming from.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So don't develop unrealistic ideas or unrealistic expectations for yourself looking at somebody else
Instagram.
Because it with social media period because what'll happen is you start to stuff start to come into your mind you're starting to feel a certain way it could cause you to have question stuff am I doing it right am I doing it fast enough like what so that's why you have to be careful because everybody's road is going to be different right. That's something we have to instill in our children.
Mm-hmm.
That jealous spirit. That you know, because this is the thing. It's I think it's okay to be envious of certain things, but as far as being jealous and develop hatred towards a person for it, I don't think that's good.
Right, right.
Because then you start to eventually. Then when you get to where you're going, people start doing you like that, and you see exactly what you know what it felt like and it's not a good feeling.
Right.
Goes back to treat people how you want to be treated.
That's true.
Treat people how you want to be treated. So when you develop these unrealistic ideas of how people live and guess what? Don't worry about the Joneses again. Like you can't worry about the Joneses what they doing.
What they say nobody
your playbook
talks about
is different.
Failures. Nobody posts their failures.
Right.
I got one question.
Absolutely.
Let's switch up just a little bit.
What's up?
Did y'all get a chance to take in the Donald Trump thing last night?
No.
The rally?
No.
The rally. All those empty seats and stuff by the people.
Say it was the biggest rally in America.
Oh yeah, it was so many
it
people
was.
Trolling them,
mm.
ordering tickets to the rally and didn't show up to the rally.
Mm.
That's why they had so many empty spots up in there.
But I was trying to understand why would you want to hold a rally with like 19,000 people, like 20,000 people.
Because if you're not the type of person, you need to feel like. You are the
he had like but six of them staffers that had corona had
that's
COVID.
What I'm saying like right. That was dangerous. I don't know. So how does that work? Like because I know they say he was doing it on Juneteenth.
Well, at first he was gonna do it on Juneteenth.
He wanted to. They wouldn't let him.
Yeah.
But he wanted to on purpose, in my opinion.
Definitely
of
on purpose.
Why would it? So I had some people that was going against the grain on Juneteenth, right?
So this
guy on my social media, he was like just kind of discouraging people. And I was just like, why would you discourage somebody not to celebrate the one thing that kind of, you know, involves us or whatever. So he was like, well, I just don't feel like, you know, that's nothing to celebrate. And I was like, okay, but discouraging people not to celebrate when you celebrate everything else is just like.
Whole thing, you have a choice to celebrate. Don't down.
That's what I'm saying, but don't discourage
something.
Somebody from. That's just like I don't celebrate holidays. But do you think I'm walking around saying, "Man, you need to stop celebrating Christmas"? No, I'm not going to discourage you from celebrating nothing.
You got haters, and for some reason, people just decide to be a hater.
Yeah,
and
that's
to just
really
go against
though.
The grain, and not saying that you got to be with everybody else. But if you are indifferent about something, don't mean you got to always speak on it.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't have to down it.
Yeah.
You know, like you sharing information.
You got to agree to disagree.
Or informing people. On, like, say, for instance, like I told him, I was like, giving information like this is what happened in 1865, whatever, whatever. That's different from you just outright just talking about y'all dummies. And I'm like, dude, you're being really
And you know what I think you have to do, unfortunately, when you have people like that, you really have to disengage with conversation with them. Because I think the more we talk to them, and I mean, unfortunately, it's just like about, you know, what we deal with politically. The more we talk about people, the more airtime we give them, the more juices flow. Because again, we don't know what their end game is. Yep. We don't know if they in it to antagonize or to, you know, just create a riot. We don't know what their end game is for.
That's
because
true.
You got a lot of people who people go into these into these different worlds on Facebook or just social media or even at the top level that they have an end game. And their end game can be to get you to be out of control, show your emotions, show that you don't have no, you're not cool, calm, and collected. Right. So it's always an end game.
He said he made Juneteenth famous.
Yeah. Right. I mean, to hear that is amazing, man. To really hear that statement is amazing
because
it shows how disconnected he really is.
And his followers.
Let me tell you, how can I say this? So, like, he mentioned it. Which, of course, is something that I don't think it had been done on a platform like that before. Have you ever heard anybody else mention Juneteenth?
Not that I can remember.
Yeah, that's what, and I feel like that's what he's trying to take and run with it. Mm-hmm. Even though,
why do you want credit for something that, like?
Because that it's a political time.
Cloud chasing.
You've heard people talk about it. And you've heard people talk about it in the community, but I'm saying at that level, it was just, I feel like, I mean, it was a wild statement to make. And again, to want to be the one to hold the trophy, that's when you got to start thinking about people really internally. Right. You want to be the one to hold the trophy to make this statement on something that's been here forever.
But that lets us know why he made it, though.
Yeah.
So it kind of shows us what his motive was for even making a statement. Because in all honesty, I know for me, I haven't heard anyone say on a platform like a presidential platform or thing of that nature, but the timing.
He's trying to appeal to his blacks.
Right. Yeah. That's what I'm saying. His so the blacks. Timing is definitely right for him to do that.
Look at my blacks up there.
Yeah.
Look at my blacks.
Right. So the timing is definitely right at this point, you know, for him to say something about it. But as far as him making it, No, that's not what happened.
Yeah,
it was timing.
Right.
Like, he got to appease his black followers or black, you know, supporters some kind of way. And to be perfectly honest, most black people that support him
don't care about
stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they don't.
They
like
think
it's
unnecessary.
They think
we need to assimilate
say this.
Better.
Yeah.
I'll say this. If they care, they won't let him know.
Right.
They won't make him aware.
Right.
Because again, you got people within his party who's been either fired, resigned, and you got people now coming back saying things that were, you know, not so good as it relates to performance.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So what's really happening at that point? I mean, it's just like any of us. We go to a job every day, and we know our boss and our mind and what we got going on. We not connecting. But if I know I got mouths to feed, I'm not gonna do I'm not gonna do something to take away from them baby's mouth I got to feed.
Right, right.
You know, I'm gonna strategize this thing out and play it.
But when it's
I'm
over,
have
I'm gonna
finesse
talk about
with
your
ass. You know, and that's what's happening. So even some of those people that are in his party who will never say nothing now, watch the number. The number gonna rise of people who will say, you know, different things.
He's trying to stop John
him.
Bolton's book right now. I can't wait for it to come out.
He got that niece book coming out too.
Oh yeah, yeah. His niece,
you got a lot of people who gonna start coming out and probably saying some things about his performance.
That general was like, he on his ass, like.
Yeah,
like
but it don't it but that don't help when the media start targeting him.
Right.
Why you didn't say it then?
Right.
As if they never worked professionally and understood
and
the game.
And know you
have
to bite your tongue to keep your job.
Understood the politics of working.
We know that Fox News going to root it out.
Oh, yeah.
And
Not
and that's because the one thing about it, like I don't really look at the media like that. Like I read articles, but as far as like looking at the news and stuff like that, I don't really do that anymore because of how things go on with media. Like mm-hmm. they drive certain things certain so hard.
All the time, yeah,
yeah.
You have to have a combination of
don't feel like
TV
it's healthy
and print and mm-hmm. internet news. You have to mix those three things together in order to find your truth within those. You can't just watch one. Mm-hmm. You can't just watch one source of news. It's not possible. You have to mix them up.
You got to educate and empower yourself.
Right, right.
Yeah, that's
you really do. You know, I mean, and it's the same as it relates to religion. You
absolutely.
Know, we take our kids or, you know, our grandparents took us or however we got mm-hmm. to become a part of church or whatever. Mm-hmm. But even though that person that's sitting up giving us that message, we can always go back home and open up that book mm-hmm. and
right.
go in that passage and dissect it.
That's right.
And, you know, and probe and fact find, just go through that and say, does it really say what I just heard today?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? But that's what we got to do more of. We got to really start empowering and educating ourselves.
That's right.
So when we hear it out there, on any platform, we can go back and dissect it.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, and take notes. Like, it's like we have these smartphones, man, take notes. You don't have to take anybody's word for anything.
Right.
Like, if
you
it's
don't.
Something that concerns you, take
mm-hmm.
notes on
really
it.
Don't.
And then for yourself, you go, because that's one of the best parts about technology. Like, it's kind of readily there. It's there.
People who are ignorant now choose to be ignorant.
Exactly.
Like, if you choose to be uninformed now, mm-hmm. it's on you. Like,
one of the best sources of information I found on the internet is from these colleges, certain colleges. A lot of these kids who do doctor, who goes over to their PhDs,
uh-huh.
they write thesis. So they'll write a thesis on a certain subject, and a lot of times on the internet, you could type in the subject you're looking for, and you will actually find a thesis PDF that you can download for free.
Mm. Oh, wow.
And
okay.
those theses are done. When you do a thesis to get your PhD, you actually have to go and research because they're going to go back and it takes them like a month to grade your thesis. So you have
really?
To. Yeah, because they have to
fact
check everything.
Yeah.
You have to
and
defend
make sure
it.
It's not plagiarized.
Right.
For one, make sure it's not something that you've copied from someone else's book. Right. And number two, they got to make sure that you research and got as many facts and truths as you can about that subject. Whatever you choose, if you choose to write down how Windows was made, they're going to take a month to grade that paper to see. So a lot of theses are really researched very well because in order to get your PhD, you have to make sure you pass that part. If you don't pass that part, you don't get no – I don't care what your grades was up until that part. Mm. So a lot of theses are online. A lot of universities will publish those theses online in PDF form.
So people are using those or they just like using them as a reference?
I'll look at them and read them. To research some stuff or to look up some stuff or to get a different point of view about certain things, but they are free information.
And it goes back to what we were talking really? About earlier in the conversation.
Mm-hmm.
It's the information age.
Oh, yeah.
And
right.
it's really out there.
Definitely.
But we live in such a microwave society
mm-hmm.
that we in a rush to get that answer.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
We want the changes. If something pop off tonight, we want the
changes
tomorrow
right.
at 11 o'clock. And that's not realistic.
Not at all.
And you wouldn't even want the reactions to be so fast. I wouldn't anyway, because sometimes we miss certain things and then we have to recant, have to go back,
mm-hmm.
have to reevaluate stuff and then issue out apologies and issue out, you know, it's just, it makes it, when you try
to clean the process.
Yeah, it's just, it's not right. And at this point in our lives, I feel like even if you just make a statement and say, in a few days, you know, I'll come back, you know, just let them know that you're concerned.
Mm-hmm.
This is what's going on. I understand what's going on, but give me a few days.
Mm-hmm.
I'd rather that than for our leaders or, you know, to make these rash decisions and then have to come back a few days later and have to kind of like change it or because
there is a cause and effect
exactly.
on it all.
Exactly.
It's a cause and effect, and it's going to hurt somebody in the long run.
Mm-hmm. Mm. And so it's like Atlanta now, because you know, like when people come to Atlanta, it's the land of opportunity. It's always been thought of as the land of opportunity. And I'm just going to touch on this because it's when it comes down to pretty much We all know that it's a tale of two cities.
Right.
And I always talk about it being a tale of two cities.
Must be two sides.
Because with us, it's just kind of weird how it works because we're on both sides to a certain extent with our dad being a part of APD and with our mom being, you know, in the social work world. So we kind of can see things that a lot of people that's on either one of these sides,
piece it together.
So like when we look at the officers that are calling out now that are you know, don't want to be a part of what's going on because they felt like our leadership kind of failed them. They felt different ways about it. It puts us in a mental state of being a citizen of Atlanta not being a good idea, right?
Right.
My whole thing is, them people calling out and don't want to be cops no more, because you're not allowed to kill people no more. Like, I understand the morale being low, and people feeling like the leadership has failed them, but stands have to be taken against shooting folks and killing people.
But I think the delivery of...
Even if they're guilty.
Let me tell you, I think the delivery of how they're getting what they're getting, I think that makes a difference. So say, for instance, you're a police officer, right? Just say you're a police officer, and the very first time that you hear something is from a live conference. That's a problem. Because, and I think that's kind of like where they are. Because you think about it. It's like, why am I hearing this when everybody else is hearing this? Like, hell no, that ain't really, that's not really how
they
it goes.
They were
not,
put in a unique position, though, of trying to make a decision quick.
Perfect example of being quick. Let's go back to being quick. My example of being quick, when you're in leadership, right, it's okay. Like to me, as a citizen of the city, it's okay for leadership to be like, look, it's a lot for me as well as it is for you all, but I am working. So, like, let me do what I need to do instead of abruptly making a decision and making the people that work for you feel like you don't care. Like, that's the last thing you want them to do because they're the ones who have to protect you.
Let me ask you a question. So you think the city jump took too quick of a conclusion of prosecuting these guys?
No, I think that
the firing was too quick.
No. I think that the police officers needed to have special attention amongst themselves and our leadership before leadership
announced
it to us.
So you think that they should have did a better job of talking to the officers?
Absolutely.
Presented that to the public?
Yes, I don't think that the officers, because you got to think about it, it's hard working for somebody that you don't trust, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It's hard working for somebody that you don't feel like will go to bat for you, right? So what
my whole thing, quit shooting folks, unarmed folks.
Well, we get
black
that.
Black folks.
We get that. But what I'm saying is, like, because I'm told, like, I want it to be fair and but around the board. Like, I want that. But what I'm saying is sometimes you have to do things a little bit different to get the kind of results that you want. Now, these police officers, I feel like, know that something has to change, right?
Oh, it got
to They change. Feel like something has to change, but it's how you set them up for it.
And let me speak. I think, you know, we really at just an unfortunate time.
We are.
Where we got to be. You know, we talked about it being two sides. And the reality of it really is two sides.
It is.
Because just like we grew up in the city of Atlanta, on the West Side, during a different time, we got a lot of people that we know that are law enforcement.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. And those people got families.
Absolutely.
Those people got husbands and wives and families, you know. Mm-hmm. So they, too, are thinking about their protection and – unfortunately, man, I think in anything that you have going on, when there's a large number, you got some bad apples out there. Oh, yeah. And that's the reality of it. But we got to be more empathetic and understand that it's a process. Because if we doing a lot of things in haste, it sometimes comes back to haunt us.
Absolutely.
And
you can't be emotionally
driven. With those officers,
driven.
Man, I mean, you got to think about it. I mean, they all not
I don't, it's no way in the world that I think in my mind that it's the majority that are the bad apples. I don't believe that whatsoever. I think that there's a lot of them who know about it, but I think right now with the needle really moving at this point, they're going to be more apt to even talk about performance. Mm-hmm. They're going to be more apt to call you out. You know, on the field, on the court, when you're playing a sport, if somebody ain't holding up their weight, you're going to get called out.
Right.
Because we got somebody to replace you. Right. I just think we're probably going to experience a lot more of that, where people are going to start being called out, but you still got to have patience and just calm.
I agree with
to
that
allow
to a certain
for the
extent,
change to take place.
But I think it's the mentality of a lot of these police officers. They take a natural aggressive approach toward black men or brown men. I mean minority men. And until that change, you know, I've watched interactions of police with white people, and that most times they never make them get on the ground. It's always every time they deal with us. Get on the ground. It's an aggressive approach.
Set us right. On the curb.
Yeah, right. It's like, and I think they're taught that, and it's just something natural that they do. And I told y'all about what happened to me. I think back now. I've been thinking about that a lot, way more than I thought about it at the time. Because at the time, I was just goddamn like, shoo, I ain't die. Right. You know, I ain't get killed. I got home. You know what I'm saying? I ain't never have to deal with it no more. But now that I think back, I'm like, man, that was some real bullshit.
Right.
Well, yeah.
But
like,
that's kind of how I want us to kind of educate and empower to those that are disconnecting. Mm-hmm. We got to understand, and it's not only with our youth, man, and just dealing with law enforcement, but it's in everything. We got to live to fight another day.
Definitely.
And we shouldn't be out here trying to fight every battle.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it's a different way to get to a resolution without trying to fight every battle.
You definitely
battle.
Have to pick. You have to pick
you
your
pick
battles.
And choose your battles, man.
Because you know it takes a lot of energy, and a lot of times we waste a lot of energy on stuff that don't even
matter.
That right. Don't matter.
A lot of times we do things. A lot of times, a lot of people in stores, white folks who own stores, they approach us as guilty.
Oh yeah,
we're automatically guilty because they think that we are. You know, like you said, when they had a perception in their head, they already assume, you know, when they start assuming stuff, they already have that perception that is going on. So if they pulled you over, they figure, okay, I done pulled you over. You must be doing something wrong. You gotta be doing
Or they gonna make
else,
you be doing
right,
something.
Or you gotta be doing something else wrong. And then that whole thing starts an aggressive
and see what they do, they try to frustrate you till you get to the point of saying, man, like why? Well, you?
Yeah, then you start mouthing. What, I'm like, what the fuck are y'all pulling me? You know what I'm saying? Then you got a whole.
Oh, now, are you resisting?
But this is what I'm saying. When it comes to making and we always know the good stuff with the bad. Sometimes we get that. All I'm saying is to bridge that gap with police officers, citizens, and the leaders of a city as big as Atlanta. It's no way that they should find out certain things during live coverage from the media. What I'm saying is, when you see something going on, you need to, like, whatever you got to do to get, if you got to be somewhere on the 3-to-lamb shift to get hold of people, call a meeting. It's something, like, it's no way that all of our officers should feel. You feel what I'm saying? Like they shouldn't feel like they don't have anybody backing them because the realistic part of it is.
Is that what happened?
They got the union backing them. I don't agree
with that. Is that what happened?
Listen to what I'm saying.
I think that the police have a union.
Yeah, a strong union.
What happens is that when you don't go through that union to do the things the way that they want you to do it, they feel that it's a sign of disrespect and disloyalty to them. And that's not necessarily the case. Everything we get mad at police when police are not charged or when they get off with stuff, it's because the union makes it so. So if we
I'm not even talking about.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm not.
You're talking about the morale
I'm
of the officers.
About the
not
morale,
knowing what was going on.
Exactly. I'm talking about.
But
the
that's
morale
just the timing of it. They're trying to make a statement. You got somebody
they
that
trying
got
to scare us
but
into submission.
But listen to what I'm saying. But being emotionally driven in leadership is not always
good
is mean, what I'm
I agree,
saying.
I agree with that.
So what I'm saying is, like, it's ways that you have to do certain things. So, I get that. But what I'm saying is, it's okay for leadership to say, look, I'll be back with you all. You know, I'm working. This is what's going on, whatever, whatever. And reach out to your officers. Like I said, you don't want to have somebody working for you that's supposed to be protecting you and go to sleep on the job. Because guess why? They feel like you ain't gave a damn about them. So what I'm finna do for you? You feel what I'm saying? So in order to have that morale, there are certain things that's going to have to take place in our city in order for them for everything to just kind of come together. That's the only thing I'm saying.
I think they morale low more so due to the fact is
they know they finna get ready with all
this. Yeah, like let me tell you something. It's no way that man should have died out there. Even with him being under the influence of alcohol, even with him resisting not wanting to go to jail, I want everybody just put themselves in this position. Everybody, I'm sure, has had a drink before somewhere and drove home. Imagine stopping off on your way home to get you something to eat and nodding off at the goddamn drive.
Damn, a drink. I done been at work at jobs at night and get off at 3:00 in the morning because I'm working
two jobs. And be tired.
And have to stoplight and fall asleep.
Listen, imagine just waking up with the police at your window and trying to piece together
what
the hell finna happen to you. All you can think about is, I got my dog, this going on. He explained to these. It's no way under any circumstances It's no way under any circumstances that man, that should have turned into a murder. I don't agree with that man. I don't agree with none of that. I don't agree with him trying. You ought to be able to run, like he ran, but that should be a death sentence.
They had his cop.
I totally. I'm
with
you on that.
It was irresponsible.
But I'm just thinking about just not his case. It's a lot of cases that have sat with that sat on the desk of Paul Howard now for a very long time, and these families have not gotten an answer. They don't know nothing. Like, all I'm saying is you can't briskly take. See, this is where the disconnect for me is. So they're used to being able, you know, like, I ain't gonna necessarily say Paul Howard covering up for them, but in a certain sense, Paul Howard can keep these things on his desk for this long, not giving an answer, don't nobody know what's going on, these people just, you know, hurt, dead, or whatever, and the police feel protected. You just can't one day make them feel like that ain't gonna happen no more. Like, I mean, you feel what I'm saying? Like,
man, you kill.
We know it's a new day. We know things gonna change, but you can't just do it like that because of one.
The political climate calls for action like that all the time. I looked at that case in Chicago, that 16 shot with the mother Kwame Dunn. I looked at that case the other day. Like, sometimes it calls for action. Like, certain things happen that cause for change
super quick. And police in Chicago are rough.
Oh, yeah, they're terrible.
They like number two behind New York as far as worst police force. I mean, I've been walking down the street, literally from the YMCA going to the corner store, and they stopped me. Like, literally. But what you doing? Going through my pockets. I'm walking. I am not doing anything but walking from the YMCA. You see my basketball shorts on, my tank top, and I'm going to the corner store. And they had me standing on that corner up against the car, my hands on the car for like 30 minutes for no reason. But see, that's what I'm saying. I understand what you're saying, Donnie.
Don't reprimand them in front of the world.
Need to be reprimanded because they are being. Because one thing, you got to let them know that this is not going to go in on any further.
Yeah,
and the ones that can deal with
let me tell
deal
you
with
something.
And the ones that can't need to kick rocks.
If you sit around watching folks do folks wrong, you just as dirty as the person doing.
That's what I'm saying. I'm not saying. I don't agree with nobody mistreating nobody. And I don't agree with nobody saying
that. You just
nothing.
Thinking they should have got
all
more
I'm
information
saying is
and all
them
that.
Them folks should have been more prepared. Like,
man,
not and not so
I
much about what
folks.
Paul Howard said at the. Not that I'm talking about more so of.
Oh, the firings that you feel like the officer should know.
Hell yeah.
You discharge your weapon. Listen, if that man had been in the bucket, he wouldn't have shot like that, wild like that.
Man, I think they should have been fired like hell. Like I wanted to be fair across the board. Okay. My thing is, I'm not talking about them officers. I'm talking about the officers, their colleagues.
The other officers
who having the fight. You feel what I'm saying? Like,
She's
trying to paint the picture.
Other words, I get what you say.
You don't want to throw all officers under the bus.
And you can't. That's the thing. You can't. You can't. It's just like us moving. That's what I'm saying. Like, we can have some stuff going on as a business, as business owners, as bosses, mm-hmm. and one person can be a cancer to the organization is what I'm saying. You can't put, I don't think we should be trying to put all
box
officers
them in, that's
in,
all.
In okay. the same platform because, yeah. again, they just like us. They go to work just like us. And
I know
they
some
got families
good
just like us, and we know some good officers.
Exactly.
Is what I'm saying. So we shouldn't
I know,
try
I know
to. I don't think
too.
We should put them all in the same.
But I also know someone full of shit though.
We know we gonna always know that someone full of shit. But all I'm saying is,
and the ones that know they full of shit, they need to speak up on it. Like,
but
if you're a good officer,
the needle is changing.
Yeah,
I think
so too.
If you're a good officer,
so
and you want to be considered a good officer,
it's just that I
talk to them goddamn assholes.
The changes that will be made internally, I feel like the officers should know before we know, if that makes sense. I feel like they should be informed, like they shouldn't find out certain things when we find it out. Like,
so they shouldn't find out they gonna get charged from the news.
Hell, I'm not talking about no charges. I ain't talking about that, period.
Talking about
I'm talking
general.
About the changes that's gonna be made, because we know it's some changes that's got to be made.
Right.
But I don't
Let's
feel
start
like,
with one. You can't shoot niggas if they ain't got no if your life not in jeopardy. Not because you think they stronger than you and you don't want to get close
right,
up on
but
them.
But I'm saying wrestling. They should find that out on the live coverage tomorrow. They should have found that shit out last week in a personal meeting that they had with leadership. You feel what I'm saying? Like, what's going to be tolerated, what's not going to be tolerated. Like,
if somebody said they can't breathe, they might can't fucking breathe.
Right. Let them up.
Motherfucker,
take
not
your knee out their damn neck.
You think
neck.
About how they can breathe and they can fucking breathe?
Right.
Who comes up with that? I can't breathe. Oh, he's just saying that. Motherfucker, I can't breathe.
Well,
I'm labored. My breathing is labored.
But that's my whole point. Like, but these are things that need to be. I just feel, I don't know. Maybe,
I'm not anti-police. I'm anti that bullshit.
Let me say this.
I love police.
Why are you here today?
I'm here out of love for my family.
Damn man, right.
And my people.
Well, appreciate you.
Well, trying to get off the sideline, man. It's time for me to get in the game and play a little bit. And people have been reaching out to me, so I'm ready. So me and that, you know, national rebel, Mooley Robinson, you know, been putting our heads together and coming up with different things. And I want to come up with some plays that we can kind of give our youth. You know, we got a lot of people that's speaking about the adults, and the adults going to be the adults. And
right.
we got a lot of people who, you know, they're going to do what they do. But we're trying to come up with some plays we can give our youth so we can move and be more prepared when situations occur.
Okay.
So we're going to start having conversations about that, how we can empower our youth, and so how they can start teaching each other how to handle certain situations.
Absolutely.
I agree.
And guidance is the way. See, we talk about that all the time because this fight is we in it. We're here. So, like, this fight is really for our children.
Absolutely.
So
absolutely.
That's what we need. We need that guidance. We need them.
And that guidance and conversation is
going
to come from Misfits Radio on their podcast. When y'all podcast going to start?
Monday evenings. They in about 2 or 3 weeks. It's going
down. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So
we're coming in live and in person.
Oh, that's going to be what's up. So
every Monday, what
it's
time?
It's going to be
now?
On Monday?
Yeah, 8 o'clock.
Oh, cool.
O'clock. Yeah.
So on So will you all have youth, the guests coming in will be youth, or how does that go?
We going to draw it out. We got a blueprint. We going to have guests. We going to have conversations. And it's just, we going to be open. We going to have family conversations.
Okay.
It's
going
to be like a family reunion around here.
Okay.
And basically at the family reunion, we trying to teach our kids how to move better and prepare.
Absolutely.
You know, just be prepared for whatever, because educating and empowering the community is what's got to happen. And again, it ain't about us. It's about the youth.
It
won't happen
in
my time, but I want our kids to be able to take full advantage of what's next.
I definitely agree, too. And I honestly feel like the same as that way. Like now it's you know, we're at a point where these children now are ready. But they got to have some direction. They have to have some guidance because they will protest to this time next year, but they need to know what they're getting out of it. They need to know what they want out of it. I think a lot of them, a lot of them don't really know what they want out of it. It's like, so what are we doing again? You know, they're doing it because they know this is what might help, but they don't know exactly what it is that they want out of it. So I look forward to seeing you guys help them, help to develop them, help to just kind of put their minds where it needs to be as far as learning the political and what I learned too. If that's something that you guys want to implement, is going over the laws, because you know I never really understood how we didn't even know some of the laws when we were growing up. We just knew, so you know how it is. Like you, it's kind of like we knew we couldn't do certain stuff, but as far as knowing laws and stuff like that, we didn't really know.
Right. That's true.
So that's how a lot of us, like, seriously, that's how a lot of us got really locked up crime. And stuff like that, and was like, the criminals damn, I didn't even know that was law. Illegal. But no, but what I'm saying is,
doing crime.
But how did
but
they,
I'm saying,
you yeah. think about it, how did they learn the law?
Trial and error.
Exactly, but we, our kids don't have to go through that because we can tell them.
If you ever been locked up, though, I'm going to tell you the funny shit, though. Sitting there and everybody asks you, what you in here for? Right? And everybody goes to tell, well, I'm in here to this. I say, oh, you all right. All you got to do is such and such. I'm in the shit, but you be like, man, I don't hear that shit. Everybody knows. So what you in here for? Everybody like, man, I'm in here for, you all right. You'll be out tomorrow. They're going to let you sign your way out. You know, like, man, this is
that's
bullshit.
What I'm saying, though. But a lot of stuff can be avoided as long as you know. Because, you know, sometimes, like, you you, like, I had a time where I had a friend that didn't even know urinating outside was illegal. He didn't know either, but he found out the wrong way.
Right.
But the whole point of the matter is because you didn't know.
I knew it was illegal. I
didn't think you were going to get
caught.
He just
didn't think you would get caught and drunk. Be bothered. I knew it was illegal. I was drunk. Shit.
But the whole point of the matter is, it's somebody child that don't even know it's illegal.
Right. That's
and it's
true.
Like, I've been peeing outside my whole life. Like, no,
man,
seriously.
Man, that police cussed me out.
So you think
that
about it,
say,
like,
pull your goddamn pants. So what the fuck you out here? Motherfucker, you know you on Lee Street.
But look, though, but can you appreciate? But look though, that particular officer, you remember that, right?
Yeah.
You weren't worried about him shooting you though, right?
Nah, man, that was last time. All I could think about while I was peeing in front of that bank.
You're right. Don't go in on him.
Look now.
All I could think about while I was peeing, boy, it'd be funny to hear them police pull up behind me right now. I'm talking about 2 seconds in. Whoop. I said, motherfucker.
but that's an example of why you can't put them in the same box.
Exactly, yeah. Because like, you weren't worried about that.
Yeah, he ain't locked me up.
They got love and compassion, and they want to take care of the community.
He ain't locked me up. He wrote me out a citation.
Yeah.
And all he kept saying, well, man, he kept shaking his head like this motherfucker got pissed.
Because he couldn't believe it. But the whole point of the matter is that's why we can't box them in because
yeah, I don't box some, all of them in
because like, some of them really do care about
most the of them just doing it for a job. It's some of them on power kicks. I'm telling you, listen.
We know
most
that.
Most of them there are just for a job.
We know that.
You
but
know,
I think the problem comes in that a lot of the officers are not from the neighborhood that they police.
Definitely.
And that becomes an issue. Because
definitely.
When you have officers, a lot of officers go from place to place trying to find a job that pays the most money. Because like Mike said, they have families they have to take care of.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely.
So if Atlanta's paying $70,000, whereas Powder Springs is paying, while Live Air is only paying $40,000, I'm going to go to Atlanta.
But yeah. But this is the thing, though. You got to think about it. Our daddy came all the way from the Grange to police in Atlanta because he was in college in Atlanta.
Mm-hmm.
And he saw what he felt Atlanta needed in order to he wanted to basically work from the inside out. You feel what I'm saying? So it's not about you being from that community. It's about you caring, period. Mm. You feel what I'm saying?
I
like,
get what you're saying.
It's not about that. And the reason why I said it is because I live in the city of Atlanta, but I got a neighbor that's an officer that's in a whole nother city.
Mm-hmm.
And we always see his car parked at his house and stuff like that. But why he chose that city, it shouldn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it shouldn't matter why he chose, but you feel what I'm saying? Like, as long as you care, period, we need some compassionate people out here. some people that understand that they ain't always been 40 and 50 years old. They will make a dumb decision at 20. We need some officers that could get to the, you know what I'm saying, that could talk to them. Like, it's a difference. Like, we have to have some compassion. Like, so what you all bringing in the youth, letting them know, because see, right now, you know, we had officer friendlies, right? These children don't look at officers as friendly shit.
Right.
Like, that's something that they don't look at the officers. They always look at the officers automatically.
Because they keep saying police kill people on their phone.
That's my whole point.
Like, what in the hell?
That's what I'm saying. So now they're desensitized to feeling like the police is there to help. You feel what I'm saying? So now they desensitized to that.
Let me tell you something.
So it's gonna take some real live nurturing and some real live things to go on for them to understand that all of them ain't the same, just like all of us ain't the same.
Listen, right. I had to realize why white folks always like the police. You know, I had to realize because most of their interactions with the white folks are positive interactions with police.
Absolutely.
So when they hear black people say, well, I got pulled over for no reason, you know, the first person white people, oh, I don't believe that.
You had to do something.
You did something. You know what I'm saying? And so, and it's like they... You get what I'm saying? That's the new shit they do. It's not just to see what you're doing in your car. Oh, it's a nice car. What's wrong with your tag light? Shit wrong with my tag light.
Well, like, that's what I'm saying. But now we got the bridge the gap. So it is out. It's at 5.
Oh yeah.
So we will be wrapping things up.
Okay, sorry.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry about
what
that.
Y'all
I'm
doing?
Trying to figure out something.
You know, I'm new to this. This is a new normal for me, so I started. No, no, you're good. You're good.
Like, huh?
You know, because we can rock. We can roll all night.
Oh, yeah. I
need to run some other plays on the way to the house.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, right.
Well, I have really, really, really enjoyed you guys, and welcome aboard, Mike.
Pleasure.
Like,
pleasure.
Look forward
to coming here, getting that information. I enjoyed it. Like I'm saying, I'm new to the team, but I ain't new to the family.
That's right. Right. That's
love
right.
Love y'all, man. I'm glad to be here, and I'm ready to put in work.
Yeah,
we've been on Mike ever since Our Lady Lord.
Yes, like literally our whole lives. Like people like, really?
The relationships are real long.
Oh, yeah.
And it's time to start pulling the relationships out.
Yeah. That's right.
We got to change it. We got to change it for what's happening.
Bridging the gaps. Yeah, like seriously, like getting everybody involved because it's going to take a team effort for the changes that we need. And it's going to take a lot of what I would say just patience and tolerance too. As we very well know, working with the youth, it's a lot. And I always tell people that, and it ain't because I'm raising the youth, but it's from being around them. So there are a lot of things that we have to teach them because nobody's teaching them.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I always say our generation hold a different kind of responsibility. Like, I love that my brothers teach Adonis what he need to know as a black man trying to grow up in the city that we're living in, but there are certain things I'm gonna miss as mama. Cause there's certain things I ain't gonna experience as a woman that he will. So, you know, I'm very appreciative. It is Father's Day. We have enjoyed every minute of the Westside Misfits Radio Show today.
Get
so
it.
We appreciate you guys. Michael Warner, we welcome you. We will see you guys in a few weeks. Have y'all thought of a name yet?
We're spending some stuff. Okay. We don't want to spend it out there and come
I
back with something different.
I love
but we
it.
Coming.
We'll see y'all coming home.
We'll see y'all next week. Same Misfit time, same Misfit station.
That's right.
Yeah. We're in the mix with the Westside Misfits every Sunday from 3 to 5. You got to tune in to the Westside Misfits every Sunday, 3 to 5. We live in the mix with the Westside Misfits every Sunday from 3 to 5.
Dope. Yeah. Chef So. MP80, Truth himself.
Chillin' with my misfits, feelin' so different. Chillin' with my misfits, feelin' so different. If you with it, come get it. Need you to listen. We gon' come with it. We gon' come with it.
Hey, DJ Lab on the ones and twos. Mission Light, you know just how we do. 316 and we in this mix. Those not up, you know we pop it too. By my nose, so it's adios. Ain't no need for that chopper screw. Chillin' with misses. Yeah, dope lyrics, you know how we do.
Chillin' with the host, Miss Light. DJ Lab.